Hello, I'd like to open the Deerfield Planning Board meeting on March 6, 2017 at 6 p.m. at the town offices of South Deerfield. Tonight's agenda is called to order. We'll review the minutes from the February meeting. We'll look at if there's some mail we should talk about. We'll take some public comment. And then we have public hearings scheduled. The first one will be the condominiums at Sugarloaf, and that's a continuation. The second one is continuation of a site plan review for 31 Elm Street regarding Cumberland Farms. Third one is a site plan review of 4 Greenfield Road, a proposed medical marijuana dispensary. And the fourth public hearing is a special permit for a common driveway, an existing driveway located on 15 Keats Road to serve 17 Keats Road. Then the next agenda item, those are the public hearings. The next one is our building inspector, Dick Kalishevsky, will present something related to a proposed zoning change to be considered at annual town meeting. Then we'll take any other business not reasonably anticipated 48 hours prior to the posting of this meeting. We'll set a date for the next meeting and we'll adjourn. Is there any comments or changes to the agenda? And we'll proceed. We have the minutes from February 6th meeting, which basically talked about all three of the things we're going to be talking about tonight. So let's make sure we go over those minutes and see if we can approve them.
You know what they say.
Yes.
You did not email those, did you?
Somebody did.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the meetings with one change. It was Mark Vallone, not Malone, that spoke about the Cumberland Farms.
A couple places talking about Cumberland Farms, the bottom of page one.
Okay.
And then also on near the bottom of page two.
And what about Mark Malone?
It's V, instead of Vallone.
Vallone.
Oh, Vallone, okay.
And John Baronis is J-O-H-N on the first page as well.
Oh, I didn't catch that one.
Where is that?
Anything else on the minutes?
I'm sorry, where was the John? That
oh, just he moved the first item, review of minutes. It moved by Kip, seconded by John. That could be other.
Oh, he has an H missing. Typo there, okay. Gotcha.
I'll second John's motion.
Yeah, moved and seconded. Any other discussion about the minutes? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? It's unanimous. So I'd like to let people know we have 6 out of the 7 planning board members here. Roger, Paul, Kip, Ron, John, and Max. So we have a quorum. We actually reviewed the mail already. And most of it wasn't just things, informational things from other towns. This one is something we can share, that we received something from the town of Shelburne Planning Board, a notice of a public hearing on March 22nd. They're going to have a public hearing. The purpose is to allow for public review and comment of the following: parking requirements, the addition, and the addition of a new Section 22 temporary moratorium recreational marijuana establishments. So the reason why we mention that is I think some other towns are dealing with, we're all dealing with recreational marijuana issues. So they're proposing a temporary moratorium, I guess, out in Sunderland.
Shelburne Falls.
Shelburne.
Can I see that letter, man?
So now I'd like to take some public comment. At this point, early in the meeting, we like to take just 2 or 3 minutes. If there's someone in the public has a comment on something that's not on the agenda tonight, we can take 2 or 3 minutes just to hear it, so you don't have to wait till the end of the meeting. But if it's on the agenda, then we'll get to it when we get to it. So is there anybody who wants to say anything that's about something that's not on the agenda? Super, moving right along. Then I'd like to open the first public hearing. So let me read that. Now buried in, because the public hearing was a while ago. Do you happen to have the notice? I thought I would have had it right here, but I don't. There it is. So I'd like to open the public hearing to continue the public hearing that the Deerfield Planning Board will hold a public hearing pursuant to the definitive plan submitted by Mark Whiteman of Futures Unlimited for a subdivision entitled The Condominiums at Sugarloaf, located off Sugarloaf Street, Assessor's Map 174, Parcel 61 to 64, that will consist of 35 new building lots for two family homes. The hearing started January 3rd, was continued to the February meeting, and now is continued to this March 6th meeting. At the Deerfield Municipal Offices, 8 Conway Street, and copies of the plans have been available for inspection by the public. So I think we've made some progress. The last meeting, we had a peer review person for the town to look at everything involved here. So that person has done some work and is here. So I'd like to ask Sarah Campbell, the engineer, peer review, to come up and participate in this, as well as Pat Smith from the Franklin Council of Governments. Can we make some
cheers
for those guys? Yeah, for those two.
Rachel, I'll take this side, and you can have that.
And then before we get going on our sort of checklist of things, is there anything that the applicant, any changes or any additional information that we haven't heard up to this point that we should hear?
Give the board, we've been working with MassDOT as far as addressing comments that they've had. There's been some minor revisions to the plan relating to drainage, and then also a few minor comments out at the intersections for Sugarloaf that they've had us address. I've relayed that to your peer review engineer and also submitted revised calculations so that she would have them when she was doing a review, just trying to do it as efficiently as possible. So I can go over those changes with the board whenever you want to discuss those, or if you feel it's important to look at those.
Sound like with a peer reviewer as well.
Yeah. Right way to handle it. So I think we should just maybe start at the top and march through. I think one of the things we want to determine tonight is what information that we have and what's missing still. And if there's enough missing, we might continue it. We have made, I think last meeting we said we don't want to just keep continuing this too long, that we need to have an end in sight. It's the 90 days, I believe, that we had, whereas officially would come up in March 19th, is that what we, 16th? So that was, that's our goal, but everybody wants to do this properly, so the main thing is what information do we have and what do we need to have? So Pat, you're kind of doing, being our, keeping track of everything, and then Sarah's getting into the details, who should go.
Right. So I had, at our last meeting, I had presented a first draft of the definitive subdivision plan review and stormwater permit report. I have not updated that yet because I hadn't had the opportunity to review Sarah's report. So it didn't seem to make sense to do it a couple times, just wait until the end. But there really are, you know, I've been communicating with the engineers on the plan and project and have everything up to date. I think now we've got everything that you have, which has been very helpful. And so really, I think at this point, you need to hear from Sarah.
And I also, there has been some other, we ask other town departments to weigh in, and we have received some new things from them since our February meeting.
We've received a couple, but there were a number of the sort of critical ones that we had not yet received. So,
but if I can maybe go over the ones that we have. So this is from the South Deerfield Water Supply. To whom it may concern, this came out on February 22nd. The Sugarloaf Well Field, the Sugarloaf Well Field Aquifer is located under the village of South Deerfield. Mount Sugarloaf and North Sugarloaf represent the eastern flow boundary with the Sugarloaf Brook as the predominant western and southern discharge areas. The northern boundary is the Kelleher Drive area. The condominiums at Sugarloaf are located within these boundaries. The South Deerfield Water Supply District is in the process of bringing the Sugarloaf well field back online as an active water source. The district is concerned with possible water contamination due to the use of chemicals and treating of roads within the aquifer during the winter, fertilizer and pesticides used on lawns, as well as storage of home heating oil. The district will try to establish a watershed protection district for the area of the Sugarloaf aquifer.
John, we haven't received a copy of that. That was February 22nd?
Yes.
Yeah, I haven't gotten a copy of that
yet. All right, so we will make copies of that.
Thank you.
And then the select board, Board of Selectmen, the board discussed this at their meeting on Wednesday, February 22nd, and voted, I'm trying to read this, do you remember? Voted unanimously?
Yep.
Voted unanimous support, including reference to their previous comments on the preliminary plan.
Again, if we can get a copy of that, it'd be great.
All right. And then Board of Health, Health Inspector, and Building Commissioner said he will attend and participate in the in the meeting when he has comments, I believe. So he didn't say much on the letter.
No, there's no concerns for either.
From vote of confidence. And I was hoping to get something from the DPW, Department of Public Works. We haven't seen anything from them yet. And we did get comments from police. In review of Sugarloaf Street, I feel that the 35 mile per hour speed limit is sufficient for safe and effective traffic flow for the area. As most are aware, Sugarloaf Street is still a state roadway and is the old Route 116 prior to the bypass being installed. Sugarloaf Street used to be a four-lane state highway. I have parked and monitored traffic flow on King Philip and Captain Lathrop as they are similar. There is no backup nor concern in regards to departure time. The line of sight on Sugarloaf Street is superior to most projects that I have reviewed over the years. With the roadway being constructed to town standards with appropriate signage, any potential safety concern is minimal at best. In short, I have no reservations from public safety perspective with this project. From Police Chief John Pachurik. So, I think that's what we have from.
So that leaves the highway superintendent, as you already said, and the fire chief, I think, are sort of two key ones that would be helpful to have their input.
Yes, and you guys have referred to the fire fire department and chief, but we haven't got it directly from them, so.
I don't think you will either. You'll have to call them.
All right, we're gonna follow up on that one.
He said it doesn't affect them, so they're probably not going to write a letter.
I mean, I think as you folks have alluded to, I think what we want to make sure is that the fire trucks can get in and out of places.
I said, please write a letter.
So, yeah, so that's what we're going to want to hear from him.
Yeah.
Did we receive something from them in the past?
I don't have the.
I think all we got was verbal from these guys.
Yeah, I don't
think we got anything from the fire department.
I think the preliminary plan, we didn't get much.
Not even from the highway department?
The highway, they may have said something in the past.
They did. Yeah, the highway department sent something at the preliminary. The fire department said, I met with them, showed them a plan, as you know, prior to us submitting the preliminary plan, and asked them for any input, and that's the information that we've shared with you in the past. But again, at that time, he said, you know, we have no qualms or problems with this. And I said, well, it'd still be nice to get a letter explaining that you feel comfortable with being able to get the trucks in and out of there. And the reason he wanted this project instead of the other one we proposed, because it gave them an in and out in two different ways. So if there was a problem with closing down one area, there'd still be a way to get people in and out of the project. Again, that's coming from me instead of the fire department. I know you like to see a letter.
So we just need, yeah, we would definitely like getting a writing from them, so we'll follow up with them. All right, so we have lots of other issues, including water, traffic, and other things, so. Sarah, you want to give us an overview?
How close I have to get to this. I appreciate having the chance to meet with you. I did go over quite a few plans and the revisions. So the board doesn't necessarily have the latest physical plan revisions, right? You're just waiting to finalize details.
I have them digitally and you have them.
You both have them.
Okay. So a couple of things have changed. As the engineer referred to, the state highway wanted to make sure that the water didn't increase to the street, so that meant moving the high spot a little bit. But the other one we talked about was the lots on the north side, or the grading toward the back. Is that something that changed since the other plans came in?
It did, and we, in the January meeting, I did inform the board that we changed that northwesterly infiltration basin and lifted it a foot based on the second round of test pitting and soil evaluation that was done out there.
Okay. All right, so I sent this off, but it was just before I left, so I realize you don't have a copy, so I'll go down through the thought process and what I put into paragraphs here. In addition to listing the documents that we had, the road construction, I started off with the right topic because that seems to be what you were focusing on a minute ago. Obviously, this was discussed during the preliminary phase, but I'm saying that the loop road construction is preferable to having a dead end or a long dead end or even extending a road out to Mountain Road, because that would change that neighborhood. So the loop construction is philosophically a good design. The layout and the curves meet the requirements. So two proposed intersections at Sugarloaf Street are shown at less than the required minimum spacing, and the waiver request has been submitted. Looking at Sugarloaf Street, it has a minimal slope in that area, about 0.5% to 1% slope, which means you're not looking at, you know, rolling topography that might get in the way of your vision. It also doesn't appear to be any curvature at all, except right down at the end by 116. The recommended site distance is 165 feet, I think, for a 35-mile-an-hour speed, and we have quite a bit more than 165 feet. You can see for quite a ways. Both the proposed intersections and King Philip across are at about a 90-degree angle, so that's a preferable layout. You want them opposite each other so that doesn't create a third point of intersection. So that's a good layout. The streets themselves, as they're designed, as they come in, are at 1.7 and 2% coming into the intersection, which means there's enough of a slope to keep water from ponding, but not so much that it becomes a sliding hazard in the winter. So that is reasonable.
Excuse me, Minister. Did you say you sent us this report?
I emailed a copy to Priscilla and to John as I left an hour ago. So as long as the site triangles are kept at the street, they don't start planting bushes at the edge and things like that, the visibility seems good. All the math works, so I don't see any reason not to grant the waiver for the separation of the intersecting streets. I looked at traffic flow on Sugarloaf Street. Mass DOT has recorded traffic counts. It appears as recently as February. They've got this information on the website, and I will, I didn't put the link in the letter, but I can do that. Their total vehicles per day is on the order of 7,000 trips, which is fairly consistent over the past several years. The additional traffic to be generated, it's 10, not 20 per house, John.
Good. 20
I threw 20 at you earlier. 10 trips per day per unit is the standard subdivision. The ITE, Institute of Transportation Engineers, publishes these things. Everybody argues about them. A lot of them are urban. A lot of them are based on huge projects, but that's, you know, kind of the Bible that people look at.
And that's per
per unit.
Per units, which is two
right.
condos per,
right.
per unit.
Right. And they also make a distinction between single family and connected, and now we're on a duplexes, which is like, I think it's closer to single family. You know, it's not a big complex. They're more like houses. They just happen to touch each other.
So I guess what I was saying is it 20
per
double condo or 10 per condo?
20 per lot, 10 per housing unit.
Okay. Right.
And that's five in and five out, or 10 out and
in
10?
In and out. So
okay.
That's total passing,
total
whichever direction they're passing.
And the same with that 7,000 on Sugarloaf? Is that both ways?
Both ways, yeah.
35, like,
right.
If it was equal?
Okay. Both ways.
Yeah.
There is a separate category that they use for over 55, and I know you want to make sure this works for the most conservative case, which is the standard single family. Those can be, again, depending on where they're sampling, between 30 and 60% of a basic single-family development, but we're going to look at that 10 trips per day or 9.7, which is in the book. The other thing they do is they break it out on a peak hour. So, you know, generally that's your morning rush hour, afternoon rush hour, when people are coming and going to work. I know when I've been sitting places counting traffic, you count it on 15-minute intervals, and then you look and find out which hour is the biggest hour, because that can be significant. You know, cars don't flow all the same all day long. Per unit in the peak hour, you know, this is a lot of numbers, but I just wanted you to know what I know. Between 0.13 and 0.34 per unit, 0.13 times, where are we at, 72 units?
70.
In the afternoon, it's actually bigger, but it's got a bigger range, 0.17 to 0.95. So I'm going to look at this whole thing and just say one. One of the 10 happens right at each rush hour. So if you're looking at something like 74 trips in the peak hour, that's on the order of 10% of the traffic. Yeah, 718 total trips per day is about 10% of that 7,000 trips on Sugarloaf Street.
Right.
So somewhere on the order of 10%. Now, looking at the traffic counts that were done by the state, over the past 10 years, they were, one year was up as much as 8%, one year was down 9%. I don't know if that's when, you know, pickles went out longer ago than that, didn't they? You know, something happens and something changes, but plus or minus 10% over the past 10 years is about what the normal background traffic has been anyway. So that gives you an idea of generally all day long on Sugarloaf Street, something like 7,000 cars, and then maybe 700 more going in either direction at any given time. Again, I know you're not assuming this is going to be over 65, but those peaks shift because they're not necessarily leaving first thing in the morning. The peak, there's all kinds of charts. The peak from the development versus the peak on the street and all that kind of stuff. But I'm just going, I think the, you know, one trip per unit on the peak hour and 10 per day is a good rule of thumb to look at. So it's not overwhelming. You've got two exit points. I wouldn't say that all the ones on the north leg will go north and the south leg will go south, but, you know, you've got some separation that way.
Yeah.
And you've got a lot of sight distance on a straight, flat road in front of you. So in my opinion, it looks like it's a reasonable design as far as the roads go. So then going down the list of other topics, water supply. Water and sewer are municipal, as we know. The water supply follows the loop of the street. It's shown on the standard section as being off to the side of the road. The hydrants are on the same side as the water main. The plan is showing only one service line per lot for two units. I know Roger said he thought separate connections for each unit. Even though one line in would have 2 meters, I guess that's still up for discussion. They said they'd change it if that's the way it should go, but that's just slightly different because you've got one lot, two units. They need to be independent because they're obviously metered independently, but is there concern over getting access, I guess, if it comes in, depends on where it comes in. And those are, you know, details that show up with the building plans themselves, where the meter sits and that kind of thing, but I think that's still up for discussion. The town's hydrant is the Mueller, which should be specified on the plan eventually. I know, obviously, that happens also when they come in for the permit, but sometimes things like that get missed.
We'll make that change on the plan so it's definitive.
Which is that?
We'll call the specification out on the hydrant on the plan so it's definitive, so it's there and it's clear when they go in for construction that's the type that needs to be installed on the property.
Yeah, it's a generic little guy on the detail sheet, you know. Nothing too special with the sewer collection system. They're 8-inch PVC. They're pretty much minimum slope, which you would expect on a flat site. There's sufficient cover to meet the specifications, so nothing too interesting there. So then back to the soil conditions and the test pits.
Wasn't there also going to be gas lines going in there? Didn't you say that? Or is that separate?
Yeah, so I've been in constant communication over the last month with Berkshire Gas, and it wasn't pleasant. I don't suggest it. They actually ran it right through to the top of Berkshire Gas and to their attorneys, and they're not allowed to even allow me to install a gas line because of the moratorium. If the gas line is installed in Massachusetts, as I understand it from them, it has to be used immediately or it has to be voided and it expires. So they were pushing for me being able to install the gas line at my cost, which they would normally install at their cost, and then they were going to fill it with liquid nitrogen and nitrogen gas and then cap it to show that it was holding. And then when they lifted the moratorium, they would allow me to then start using it, and then they would pay me back because we would have enough usage, obviously, inside the subdivision. That is not going to happen. So I've spoken with two of the larger propane distributors in the area, and we're intending on putting some propane tanks throughout the project buried so that we can supply multiple units with single tanks so we're not having to cart the stuff in by a truck every day to 70 different units. But I do want to use some sort of gas. It makes more sense these days. I'm not interested in putting oil tanks in here, so we think that's probably the safest and most convenient alternative to the gas line that we're not allowed to install.
Will that go through fire department?
Yes.
they're, you know, typical setbacks in that there's plenty of room in front to be able to put those tanks in, so it's easy accessibility for filling in that, just because of the lot margins and how we set the buildings, just so you know.
And the first company that came back to me was Osterman down in Sunderland, and they've done several projects like this. And it has, they say it's the, we were looking at possibly doing a field, you know, of propane tanks, but it's just be ridiculous in size. So this made more sense to spread them out during, throughout the project.
So how many units could get, could come off of one tank?
Four per unit, yeah, 1,000-gallon tank. Best alternative.
So that's two duplexes then?
Correct.
So then you're talking that that's it for life then?
That's it.
You'd never, you're not going to put gas in once the neighborhood's all built
up? No,
maybe
not. Well, unfortunately, you know, they're sort of doing this themselves, you know.
Just out of curiosity, so out of that, you would have to meter each house still? How would everybody get paid for their...
I own some apartments up in Shutesbury, and they did this years ago for me. We put in a large tank in the backyard, and we have separate meters, just like the electric company in the back of the units. Yeah, unfortunately, they're not... to the point where they can read them like the electric company, they'll have to actually read them instead of being able to electronically do it. But that's the next step for them.
Can I ask, go back to the traffic, since we did, now on that 10 trips a day, is the mail included with that? Like, so it's everything collectively, not just what one, okay.
Right. They do all kinds of counts in different places, in different states, and then no matter who has a project, they dispute it,
so
do another
UPS
one, find another
place.
There,
the
right,
mail, the
right, yeah.
Gas
so maybe
truck,
you know,
okay.
Average, which is why a lot of these studies are a bigger developments, and those numbers change because
right,
maybe
right.
You only have one UPS truck, even right. Though you've got 100 units as opposed to
okay.
Whatever.
But it also visitors, all that supposed to be in that number,
right?
Yeah.
So it's everything collectively.
Yeah.
So okay.
Yeah.
And were there going to be bus stops in the project too, or not?
Well, we won't be able to get them in the project, but we're in conversations with both the transit lines to see if maybe we can build one, you know, a sheltered stop right in front of the project. We have a space, most southerly entrance. There's a space to the right that would be perfect for it. So that's what we're hoping for.
That's the one across from King Philip?
Yes.
So that service them too?
That's why we're thinking about there as well.
Soil.
Soil. Two sets of test pits. Fairly similar results. The later ones seem to have a little bit higher water table. They're not finding flowing water. You know, it's looking for color samples of where it might have been moving through. So it's, you know, that's another art to studying the colors of the soil and that type of thing. The soil testing pretty much confirmed what was expected in the soil mapping. You know, the general descriptions are not too far wrong. You don't know exactly where those boundaries are, but in general, it's pretty sandy stuff, you know, a little finer in places and coarser in others, but generally suitable for infiltration. The groundwater was between 6 and 10 feet below the surface. The higher logs were seen on the north side. The change in the grading after development is not significant because, you know, it's flat. So things are being contoured. The stormwater basins are being cut down, but only by 2, 3, 4, maybe 4 feet in places. So you're not doing massive earthwork where you're going to start worrying about intersecting the groundwater.
What's the depth on the north side? You said that's where the water
The closest one was about 6 feet to the surface.
And that was the north boundary?
Yep. North, northwest?
Yes.
Yeah. The overall drainage structure as it's proposed is to intercept the runoff off the hill in the back, bring it in both directions around the north and south, and take the onsite drainage as well as what's coming from the uphill side and separate that into three shallow storage areas, infiltration areas. We call it, I guess, a retention basin. Because of the watershed that you mentioned in the water department letter, the water coming off the street goes through an oil and water separator. Two of those?
Two. Either side of the loop road.
Because you can't introduce dirty water into the ground in the aquifer. So in two places, they're picking up street runoff, piped runoff, and putting it into an oil and water separator. But the rest of it is coming around the back in an open channel. The increase in the pavement, the road, the driveways, the roof area, the impervious area, is then balanced with being able to store it and infiltrate the water in these three locations. The southern one is fairly close behind the existing house, so close to the west side. The central area is in one of the lots that's not a building lot, that's designated with a gazebo, you know, a little gathering area, but it's also the low area around it is for rainwater storage. And then the other one is in the jog in the northwest corner. So these are fairly flat. The grading is flat. It's not something that looks like a pond. It's not something that looks like these terrible things at shopping centers where they're compressed. You know, it's spread out, it's only a couple feet deep, and it's mowed like the lawn. Until it rains, you don't know it's there. Even after it rains in a small storm, you hardly know it's there. Because it's shallow, it's got a wide bottom and it starts to infiltrate. There are leaching catch basins, dry wells in all three basins to get the water down, say if the surface is frozen, so it won't sit there in snowy conditions. And in between the catch basins, they're connected by just a flat pipe. You know, one thought was maybe you could put perforated pipes in there, just add a little infiltration. But the idea is just to equalize them, make sure whatever's happening is balanced in all of these three basins. So the overall site, the developed site, is balanced and compared to the existing conditions for a 2, a 10, a 25, and a 100-year frequency storm. I talked about the perimeter.
Can you restate that?
A 2-year storm, a 10-year storm, a 25, and a 100-year frequency storm.
They claimed that they were going to design a system that could handle 2 100-year storms.
Well, the 100-year storm doesn't overtop anything. I don't know about what happened in the past, but
their claim in engineering was that they were going to design a system to handle 2 100-year storms. The 100-year storm in Amherst was 15 inches of rain, which comes out to 30 inches of rain over an acre, which is about 16 million gallons of water on 20 acres.
Well, 100.
So those shallow little ponds you have there are not going to accommodate the flood on a 2 100-year storm as they claim they're going to do to protect the neighborhood.
Well, I got to try to understand the terminology. A 100-year statistical frequency storm is 6-point-something inches of rain. And I don't know what a 200-year storm is because that's not the.
Storm.
Well, but a 200-year storm is not something that's usually.
He's gone 100.
So I understand, but
that's,
it's...
That's good. We're going to have questions in a little while, so let's continue those comments. But so if you just continue with your 100-year storm, why don't you stick to that?
Yeah, and generally the DEP requirements that I think the town has modeled their stormwater management requirements after are focusing on the 25... Well, the 2, because it happens often, because the first flush happens all the time, and, you know... what is going to happen there. The 25 is usually what your pipes are designed for, and it's happens probably more often than 25. But again, like the traffic, we're only, you know, we're looking at statistics and we're looking at standards that are set across the country or across the region. And then the 100-year storm is a what-if. In all cases, the stormwater is managed in these various basins, and it's what I call sometimes you run it around until it gets tired, you know, because it's going back and forth, it's infiltrating. Once it gets out of the concrete swale, anywhere it's in an open swale, as you come into these basins, you've got a forebay, which is the purpose of that is to maintain any sediment that runs in instead of maintaining the whole thing, so it kind of makes it easier to keep on top of these things. So you've got a lot of water running on open ground, and very little running in pipes, which is, the buzzword is LID, low impact development. You know, the less you have in pipes, the less you concentrate it, then you don't have it shooting out of a pipe and causing erosion and that kind of stuff. And the more it's out in the natural, the more it's infiltrating inch by inch, you know, as things go on. So what we do is we calculate the peak rate, okay, which is, you know, as it rains, it runs off, you hit a peak, and then it slows down over time. And again, this is a statistical storm. It's not the exact storm that happens. But that's the way it's done, and that's the way it goes into the computer program. So based on holding the water back in these basins, the peak is lowered, and the peak in this case goes out to the street, which is a state road, which is under their jurisdiction, which is why they've been pretty hot on making sure those peaks don't get increased into their pipe system, because that's a pipe system. So the calculations show that all of those four storms are in fact attenuated, and the volumes are held in these basins. I looked at how deep the water gets in the basins because they are so broad. The 100-year storm in the north and the central one, it's maybe a foot and a half deep. The one in the southern corner is more like 4 feet deep because that's got more of a slope to it and it's more condensed there. But it's only for a short period of time. So going through the calculations, the different coefficients that are used, you know, it's done the way I would do it. It's done in generally accepted practice. It's a pretty complicated analysis because the various leaching basins are put in there as separate structures. There's a whole lot of points in this analysis, which is why we do it with a computer now, where we used to do it, you know, with an abacus and a pencil.
So the question is, does this system handle 100-year storm?
So it looks to me like there's the ability to hold more than a 100-year storm, and it does knock the peak down to what the peak should be beforehand. So what happens if there's a more than 100-year storm? You've got a great big flat area, and essentially the pond just gets bigger and bigger. You're another 2 feet, I think, beyond the top of the basin, aren't you, on the north side?
I know that the top of the basin to the weir is a foot typically. So okay. It gets up to the weir, then it's going to start discharging a lot more water than is if you had it controlled some way. But we hold, I don't believe we discharge in any of the 100-year storms out of those basins. So they hold them all and infiltrate. We were to have more than that, very significant or multiple significant storms, then it's going to drain out, it's going to get in to the street system and then off. All of the houses are high, adjacent houses that are there are high, it's not going to flood anything. It'll get out to the system in the street and go, or run down in Sugarloaf Street.
And you had talked about some basements and some non-basements, is that still what's happening?
No, based on the soils evaluations, we have the basement bottoms up from the estimated high water tables at least a foot and a half to 2 feet. I believe they're mostly 2 feet.
So you have some places that have basements and some that don't?
They're all basements.
They're all basements.
All basements.
We're staying a foot and a half to 2 feet, foot and a half to, or a foot to foot and a half above the water.
Okay, all right. Because I thought you originally had said some might, some wouldn't.
That was before we done.
That was before we did all of the testing.
All right.
Yes. So the overall direction of flow is towards Sugarloaf Street. The outlets are instead of pipes, again, you've generally got a weir, so you've got it spread out, you've got it filtering over the top and spreading out again slowly. So it's not a case where you've, a lot of times when you're heading toward, I don't know what, you're going downhill toward the river instead of the street on the backside of a different piece of property, you know, sometimes you're ending up funneling it out in the pipe and then you forget about the pipe because it's off in the woods. In this case, we're going into the street. We've got the state keeping their eye on the piping system in the street. And is there a low spot? It keeps going on down to 116, doesn't it? I think, you know, ultimately that's the direction it flows. It just spreads out and ultimately goes downhill if it were to overtop. But you've got a fair amount of storage even beyond that 100, you know, incrementally. But there's something called a probable maximum storm, but that's another theoretical thing, you know?
So the other question is, we've had a lot of discussions about that part of town and the neighborhood. So what about other properties on both sides of this? You got Mountain Road to the west, northwest kind of. What are the chances it goes over there?
You've got a perimeter swale coming down the majority of that side, right? From the west all the way down the north till you get to that corner where it juts out.
Yes, and at that northwest side, it's higher along the property line. So any water that builds up in that basin is directed to a weir. On that north side, it'll drain overland. If it does top that weir, it'll drain overland, get into a dry well, which connects to another dry well, which connects to the catch basin that ties to the state system in Sugarloaf. So when we say these basins, if they do overtop, if there was a fairly large storm and overtop, it's controlled. It's not just haphazard to run out.
It's not like a swimming pool. You know, the top is not all the same level. Hmm. So it's got a direction it wants to go in, which is following the outlet toward the street. So it's higher on the northern property line side, and as it comes out of that basin, it's just, it's a dip, it's a weir, mm-hmm. that it would flow over and head toward the next catch basin, as he said, and then out to the pipe.
Yeah, each of those, like the middle basin, if that overtops the weir, it's gonna run to a new catch basin on the backside of a sidewalk that'll capture that water, tie it into a catch basin at the intersection with Sugarloaf, and then into the system. The southerly side, when it overtops, it's going to run through a swale. They have 10 feet strip of property that runs to Sugarloaf Street. And at the right-of-way of Sugarloaf Street right now, there's a crushed 12-inch pipe. There's probably about a 6-inch opening. And it goes to a catch basin that runs to a catch basin to the north, to downtown, and then turns adversely back. And that pipe is really flat. So we're going to improve that. We've told MassDOT, and this is some of the drainage discussions we've had with them, in order to improve that condition, we're still going to leave the pipe running to the north, that existing pipe, but what we're going to do is we've got a drop inlet, we're putting it in that 10-foot strip to get water into it so it doesn't flow out over the right-of-way and into Sugarloaf Street. It'll get captured, run into that inlet, and then we're going to go through that existing catch basin, but we're going to make a connection to the larger pipe in the center of Sugarloaf Street. We're going to build a new drainage manhole. So that improves that whole condition that has been some comments through the public comments that there has been some problem areas on Sugarloaf Street there. So this improvements of this subdivision will improve that area considerably.
So who on the town reviews that? Is that the Public Works? Is that the Highway Department? Drainage? Yeah. I mean, all this stuff and where it goes when it gets to Sugarloaf. I mean, we say it's a state road, but it's the Deerfield that still has to deal with it.
Well, they're their pipes.
It's the state maintains that drainage system. The drainage system they're going to create for the subdivision would be the town's responsibility. That's why they're going to the state and getting permission to hook on and not discharging.
That's a state issue, right? At the,
all right, yeah. But I guess that's what I just want to make sure we have some record from the state, and that's why we want the DPW to put a comment in here about this.
I think the question John asked, you know, about Mountain Road or whatever. The topography of the land right now, Tony, before you grade it, obviously you can do anything you want and get the water to flow where you want. But right now, typically, which way does it flow?
It flows to Sugarloaf Street.
Yeah, that's what I would have thought.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're not changing overall where the water ends up. It ends up at Sugar Loaf Street. We're just managing it, that's all.
But I think, like, if you wanted to, you could grade it, you could pitch it toward Mountain Road. Obviously, you're not doing that.
Yeah, no, you can do a lot of things if you have a lot of money to fight grade and stuff. That's just, it doesn't lend itself to do that here. Everything goes to Sugar Loaf, and if you really analyze the grading plan, we go that route. And there are a number of factors that handle that. I mean, we've got to get sewer out and things of that nature. So those grades fix how we grade the site, you know? And I mean, our grading is the minimal amount to be done that meets good design criteria that's going to produce a good project. And that's essentially what we do. We don't do grading to buck what the earth really does, you know?
To a certain degree.
I mean, it's all flowing to Sugar Loaf Street.
And in Sugar Loaf Street, it's heading toward 116.
Right.
So there's not a basin, you know, there's not a place where it's going to sit, as far as I can tell from the grades that I've seen.
All right, what else? I'm going to open it up to public comment.
Sewer drainage. I think generally it is a complicated system, and I think paying close attention to it as it's built and then after it's built and then understanding how that maintenance process is going to work. They did include a checklist in the maintenance plan, but I think it would make sense for you to set up a procedure, whether it's with the highway department, even though it is their responsibility to maintain. You want to see maybe a condo document, you want to see some kind of management document that shows you what's happening, and then you want to have them maybe submit it annually. And hopefully they will submit it to somebody who doesn't put it in a circular file and, you know, maintains that. Because I think it's complicated. It works. You can see the pieces on paper. You can see the math working. And you just want to make sure that nobody forgets what was there.
Yep.
You know, being an open system, I think it's a lot easier to observe. And you've got a lot of people who can notice if there's a problem just by the nature of, you know, living there. I mean, I've seen a lot of structures go in. They put them under parking lots. There are all these chambers, and it's out of sight and out of mind. I think having an open system, you can see if there's a problem. If it backs up, you can see something needs to be fixed. And I think that's really an advantage, in addition to the whole philosophy of getting it back into the ground and not paving the whole world and you know, letting the water go back where it should, into the aquifer. So I think it makes a lot of sense. It's just a question of making sure that into the future, everybody knows what's supposed to be there. They don't accidentally move something. This is in the way of the new gazebo, so let's just fill this in. You know, you just got to make sure all the controls are there for the future. That's, I think, my biggest point.
Any questions from the planning board members?
I'm good so far.
It'll be a question that I ask later. As far as, like, our town wells go, how do we be sure that we're not doing damage to them down the road, Tony? I mean, is there a, you know, anything maybe for some monitoring wells near the town line, or
what we're required to do, because it isn't a water protection district, even though they're not online now, but it's still an active district. This came out in the ENF and, you know, some of our permitting previously. What we're required to do is to remove 44% of the total suspended solids before we discharge to an infiltration structure. So how we do that, and the understanding is if we do that, then there should not be impacts to the zone. So how we do that is on the outer boundaries, we have the swales, which are natural, and then where those swales discharge to the basins on the northwest and the southwest corners, they go through four bays, which are the initial treatment. Internal, it's a little different because we don't have the swale. We have the swales on the outside of the inside, but those get treated with four bay. On the inside, where we have curbing, where the walks are going to be, that's a standard subdivision type design, the old way we used to do it, where water will get collected in deep sump catch bases. They're hooded, so that is a credit. And then when we go and we discharge, before we discharge to the community lot in the middle, which is an infiltration area, we have to run them through. We're taking their split around the outside and they direct to the middle. We run those through two oil and water separators. So by doing that, we're taking out the dirty water. The combination of both of those, the deep sump hooded catch basins and the oil and water separators, give us that 44% reduction before we discharge to the dry wells and the infiltration structure. So by doing that, we're meeting the standard of your guidance, but also the standard DEP, wetland, stormwater management.
Right, I get that, but what about like pesticides and salts and stuff? How can we, what can we do to make sure that the salts,
the road is gonna be a public road when we're done. We're gonna petition the town to take the road over and the water, sewer, and the storm drains within the road. Okay, so that is how you manage your system as a town, okay? And as you heard in one of the comment letters from the Water Supply District, they're going to be coming out with some guidelines for the town how to manage that. So that's how that'll get managed. As far as the infiltration basins and the landscaping in that and the maintenance of the common area, because this is going to be a condominium document or a condominium association, there'll be documents, bylaws, and rules and regulations on how, what people do and how they manage that. They'll all be paying into an association. There'll be contracts let out for landscape contractors and so forth to be able to manage all of that common area, the driveways, the, you know, all of that. And they'll be, you know, what we do is do good housekeeping. I mean, you want to have a lawn, you want to have it look nice, you want it to look all the same. So there probably is some fertilizers in that to get the lawn going, more so in the beginning to get everything up and running. But after that, if it looks good, the association's not going to pay to do that kind of stuff unless it's needed. So it's managed as a whole.
Right. I would just hate to see us lose our wells again down the road.
But that's for everybody. I mean, the whole town, the whole village in that area is within that district. So it's not any, what I'm saying, it's not any different than, you know, probably the farming's more of an issue than the actual single-family homes.
Well, there's two sides of the coin. I get it, yeah.
So, but it's...
I think it's just a valid question to ask.
Yeah, no, and, but, I mean, like I said, I don't think it'll be any different than how any single-family home would be maintained.
But I think important was what the water department had stated, because our project isn't the only one in this aquifer, obviously. It's the entire downtown.
Exactly.
So we want to make sure there's something in place. And when I say we as a town want to make sure there's something in place for everyone living downtown to make sure that we're all following some sort of rational behavior down there. So
exactly.
It's not going to be problematic for the water aquifer. But it's not going to be just our project, obviously. It's the entire downtown.
Right.
No, but a new project is where we can ask for, you know, the future and have improvements so that
right.
it's not.
And so we want to follow whatever it is that the water department comes up with that will make sure that everybody downtown is being cognizant of the fact that we're in an aquifer. Yeah.
But the sad part about that is the wells that they speak of that are on 116 between the state highways and Sugarloaf Street, regardless, even if they're polluting it, you know, DOT always seems to prevail because they always cry safety. So, you know, I'm sure all of us, they spray chemicals and salt on the roads 24 hours before it even snows. And there's been plenty of times where they've got all this stuff they put all over the roads and it never snows. You know, but that's how the public cries. You know, the insurance companies lobby the state. They don't want any slippery roads and they pour all this stuff all over the ground. And, you know, if we want to, you know, preserve our drinking water, we need to get after those people. I mean, you know, not that we should not have these people be responsible, but
yes,
what they're doing is minimal compared to what goes on outside of this area.
So I'd like to take some comments from the public, and I know we have some people who want to talk about soils and water, so let's talk about that some more. If you just state your name and...
Actually, I'm pretty good with the soils in terms of where we are right now. Except, Sarah, I would say that we consider soil morphology interpretation to be a science as opposed to an art. But that's all right. But my couple of questions have more to do with the infiltration basin that's proposed behind my property. We've talked about it. We've looked at the soil pits, and they've raised the elevation of the bottom of that in response. But this is where my engineering skills fail me, because I'm not an engineer, Tony. but looking at the plans, I put for you one way, I sent an email asking about, it looked as if the bottom of the dry well in that basin actually would sit within the seasonal high water table. And I the original design didn't have any roadway runoff going into that, and so I just asked you to double check that for me, and you said with some of the changes that you needed to make now, there actually is some roadway runoff going into that. And again, it's probably a very small period of time when this is even an issue. But hearing that the well, the recharge area for the town well, you're concerned about salts, it just made me want to bring that up because, again, probably a small area, a small amount of salt, but because there would not be necessarily an unsaturated zone for the infiltration for the dissolved solids to precipitate out. The oil and water separator wouldn't do anything for the dissolved salts. Can you speak to that? Correct my assumptions if I'm in error.
No, I think you're right. The catch basins or the dry wells are about 6 feet tall. Okay, so at those few specific times of the year, it could have a little water in the bottom of them for that short period of time. That's the only time. And the dry wells are only there specifically to allow us to get by the frozen zone at the few times of the year where we have the spring thaws, March and so forth. And we are correct in saying that we did not have any road drainage there in the beginning. But we were discharging a half a CFS more to the intersection of Sugarloaf Street, and MassDOT wanted us to reduce that. So the best way to do that was to put in some catch basins and peel off, I forget how many 100 feet of road. It was like maybe 150 feet, whatever was in the email that I sent to you. So you get that portion, but it's really a portion where we have the double curve. Some of it's discharging directly into the swale. You just get that small part that goes to the north, and that's it. And it happens also on the south road that lines up with King Philip. By doing that, I was able to reduce the flow and therefore satisfy MassDOT's concerns about the two-year storm at Sugarloaf Street.
Not my area of specialty, but I wanted to bring it up in the context of the well protection area, just for that small period of time that there might be some intersection where there's no unsaturated zone to provide extra filtration.
Sarah, did you catch that? Is that something you
So you're concerned about salt going into the aquifer? Is that the okay?
Yeah, basically the dissolved solids that would not be removed by the oil water separator that would be coming in, again, during a very short window of time when the seasonal high water table were at its maximum, so there would actually be groundwater intersection in the dry well when there was surface water runoff being directed into the basin.
Yeah, the salts would be anything that was left over from the winter. You know, not because they wouldn't be salting at that time, but it would be anything that might be residue from the winter time. And I'm not sure when we probably would not be sweeping at time. The times of sweeping are usually April and October or something of that nature. But it is a short segment of road, but we have a bunch of fighting and competing interest, you know.
Yep. So. Again, another concern I hear based upon the soil evidence that we have in front of us that the basement elevations, that potentially there's basements on all the units, that they're sited about a foot and a half, maybe two, above the seasonal high water table elevation. And that's great news. My concern is if they discover something unanticipated, I only witnessed maybe four of the pits. And there's a whole lot of land out there, and there's a lot of variability. And you know, were they to encounter once they're in the ground, especially in the spring, that they find something that they don't expect, I guess the question is what is the plan? Because I'm concerned the plan is just going to be put in a sump pump, because that just is displacing the groundwater and moving it into potentially raising the groundwater onto adjacent properties. And so I have one sump pump that works well and only has to run right now for a couple of weeks in the early spring, quite manageable. But I have a neighbor immediately to my west who tells me she has four sump pumps, one in every corner of her basement.
Where do they discharge?
For long times. That's an excellent question.
Where are yours?
Mine just goes next to my house, and there's maybe 2 feet of relief. And so it just keeps rolling around and around and around. And so I'm just concerned about exacerbating that problem at the period of high groundwater. And so I understand if you're in the ground, you've got a contract or a basement, if you need to put a sump pump in that unit, but I would like there to be some acknowledgement that there's some correction that you could make to the adjacent units that, you know, wouldn't automatically just be putting sump pumps into them. As a correction.
Well, we've got a pretty good, you're right. I mean, it could be 50 feet away. It could be a little different of a lens or something there. Hopefully that could be broken through so you don't have that. If we had a little perch, there could be some lots of different earthwork kind of things to resolve that. There could be sub drains that could be put in certain areas to drain that away, to intercept it without doing sump pump kind of issues. But where we've shot or done those soil evaluations in those areas where those units are, I know we've raised them 2 feet on the bottom of the finished floor above that. But who knows? 50 feet could be something there, and I think we'll have to address that.
So the consistency that's been shown throughout the project is important. I think Dan Nietzsche had made a comment about that to Pat in a last letter that was written, that the depth of water is pretty consistent. Obviously, have some differing soils throughout the project, but the depth of water stays fairly consistent. We're, except for one, we appear to be somewhere between 90 and 120 plus inches below. So that could change, as we're saying. From a sales perspective, which is my background, it doesn't make any sense to sell somebody something that we have to worry about in the future. So if we run into an issue while we're there, not anticipated, right now it looks, I mean, we dug 31 holes. You know, we've really taken the time to dig a lot out there. If something arises at that time, we're going to have to address it, and it's going to be addressed in a fashion that appeases the customer as well as myself in the long term. This is a project that's going to take 5 to 7 years, I anticipate, to sell out. If the first year, 20 units or so that are built, we have a problem because we didn't address an issue regarding water table, then I'm looking at no more sales or a problem with sales. So from a particularly personal perspective, it doesn't make any sense to do the wrong thing at this point. Sump pumps are something I think that was done as a last ditch effort in a fashion. We'd rather not be going that direction.
Yeah. Anticipated that would be your answer. I just wanted it to.
Yeah, and we're putting it out there verbally. Sure. Thank you.
And again, I'm far from a traffic engineer, but some of the concerns that I have related to that, I don't doubt the capacity of the roadway itself, Sugarloaf Street, that is, and the trip counts that have been done. But my concern has more to do with turning traffic and whether or not that's been specifically accounted for in the analysis, and whether MassDOT is doing such an analysis. One concern, I mean, there's great visibility and sight distance between the two proposed exits. But what would happen if on the southern end you've got somebody who's making a right turn, and on the northern exit somebody's making a left turn, and, you know, and they're both, you know, judging. That's people coming out of the development. So that's one thing. I was just looking at the drawing, sitting here and thinking, that's, you know, you're looking to see the traffic coming both ways, but what about just coming out of the development itself if you're going in opposing directions? And then Sugarloaf Street itself, which again, once was, I hear, a four-lane road. There's capacity there. But right now, we have those wonderful generous shoulders for biking and parking. And I'm just thinking in terms of left-turning traffic into the development, in terms of people needing to sort of sneak around. If you think of that many trips, people making left turns in, and you've got that through traffic trying to get through, is that going to back up the traffic? And this in no way, I think, should hinder the development, but rather I would like the town and DOT to be planning for this so that we're not reacting to a problem after it's created, but think about traffic calming measures or signage if that's appropriate to deal with the additional traffic. You know, should there be designated left turning lanes? Should they restrict parking on the shoulders in those areas so that there's room for the sneak around traffic, so that there's not cars parked in those areas? That's just a specific concern that I would like someone who has a traffic engineering background to specifically take a look at, so that we're not creating a situation for current residents through traffic and the residents of the development.
Thank you. So as I read earlier, we specifically asked the police for an extra comment, not just their normal, we like it, we don't like it, but he gave us some more information about that. From DOT is something that I still have a question about on a couple projects is, they don't seem to give us a report. They make decisions, and I certainly, I think we would like some more clarification on that, because just as you said, does it require a turning lane? Or not. They say that it's wide enough, but then that's all they say is it's wide, but it doesn't say anything.
Yeah.
So I've discussed this with Pat. Does anybody else have any clue about what to do with Mass Department of Transportation?
Well, the Department of Transportation typically won't give you a report. They're going to give us a permit to build the road, the intersection. Now, we've had comments and discussions with them, and I'll, to be honest with you, it's a good point. Because when the funeral home has a large funeral, people do park along Sugarloaf Street. I've mentioned that to the permit engineer at MassDOT. The comments that have come back from them, I mean, they have a traffic engineering department. Those guys, they specifically do traffic engineering. They have a drainage department that specifically does drainage. I'm not a traffic engineer. I've been doing general engineering and land development for many years, so I know enough about it, but I don't claim to be a traffic engineer. The comments that have come back from MassDOT so far, which related to surface, not related to drainage, was they've asked me to move the sidewalk farther to the south and give its own pedestrian ramps across. So we've made that change to the drawings, okay? Typically, there'll be the old crosswalks where they were together, they're not that way anymore. They separate them, and each ramp goes to each walk. So we've made that change. The other change that they've asked me to make is to put double yellow striping at the intersections coming to Sugarloaf Street back into the development. I've added those from the stop bar back. So kind of a little definition at the intersection. And then the only other comment that they've had to date, they're not complete yet because we don't have our permit, but the other thing that they've asked us to do is we've got multiple utility connections in the road. So we've got sewer, water, storm drain, and they've asked us to mill those intersections and repave the entire intersection so it looks all brand new in there. So there'll be striping associated with that crosswalk, centerline striping, and that will all get fixed in that area. As far as any turning lanes and that, they have not asked me to do any of that work because of the the specific case where we do have parking there, it's very limited. It doesn't happen very often, so they probably will not do that. I won't say that they because when you don't have parking there, there's plenty of room to sneak by and for traffic to continue down. At the odd case, if they don't, then you could have back up until you make the turn. And they probably think that that's better than doing a bunch of striping in the street. I won't know until I get my permit, but those are some of the things that we, when we're discussing with traffic engineers, those are the things that are come up. Sometimes they don't want to do things. It makes more sense not to do things.
Would they put on the onus on you to be doing changes in Sugar Loaf Street?
They'll ask us. The things that way, yes, they will condition our permit for us to do improvements, which they just have done, as I said to you. They'll require the developer to do those improvements, which we've done to date.
And in a way, I feel like we're fortunate because we do have a state road, so the state has a department that just does traffic research and traffic studies. So it's not as though it's a street that's a town road where there isn't anybody else looking at it. You know, we have an entire department from the state that's looking at it and is going to tell us what we have to do.
But I think the point is that Deerfield residents are driving on the road, and we have to deal with whatever the issues are. And so, not that we don't trust the state, but
I would think that we would want to believe that the state's going to make sure the road is safe, or we're going to have some insurance issues, I'm sure, with the state.
So, Pat, you've spoken to the DOT person. Will they give us something in writing?
No, we didn't have anything.
Frankly, I've never seen that in the project with Matt.
No, I haven't.
It's all changes to plans between.
So we're to assume that if they authorize a curb cut, then that means it meets their safety standards.
And we won't necessarily know the final answer to that before you make your decision. When I did speak to the guy earlier on, Jay Ely, he indicated that there weren't major issues of concern there that were going to, you know, tie it up. Of course, they hadn't completed the process, and they've come up with some more things since then. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I've been involved in projects before, you know, like when the Walmart expanded in Orange, for example, and there was a question, where are you going to have a signalized intersection? Where are you going to have left-hand turn lanes? All this kind of stuff. So that project was held up because those were so significant that the plans couldn't be finished until those decisions were made, but it does not seem like those issues have been raised.
A large commercial site like that is going to do a traffic study that'll support a development.
There
even then, that will be checked.
There were four tracks that have done on that one. So,
so I'd like to take just one or two more questions. We're going to have to continue this public hearing, and I want to decide to what date we need to continue that to, and just be really clear about what other information we're missing. So if you're all set.
Just a quick question, follow-up question on that. If as the development is built out, if we find locally that there are issues, then who fixes them? Does the town have the onus to fix them, or do we then have to petition the state? In terms of, like, what's the right solution? Can we fix it internally in town, or because it's a state road, do we still have to go to DOT?
They wouldn't let you add a lane unless they thought it was necessary. So unless they decide that it warrants a change, you couldn't just go in and propose to make a four-lane section there because it is their
You can't road. Change a speed limit sign without their, I mean, it's.
Perhaps just enforcing the speed limit might.
Well, I think that's, and so the police department would be one place to start. Right. If it's a safety issue in town, then you definitely go to the police station. That's why we're going to double check, you know, we have double checked. Thank you. I had a question here, and then.
I also went to the DOT because I live on Thayer Street and I have considerable concerns. And it's not only this. There's a bunch of projects in the chamber that could and will affect our quality of life and our well-being on Thayer Street as a through street. And they dismissed it off to the town. I asked him his thoughts on Sugarloaf Street and the development and the curb cut, and he said, we passed it up. It's a town decision. State road is now a town decision. And I asked him about Thayer Street, and he just agreed with my concerns, lent nothing to the conversation, and that's how he left it. I don't know how that helps us or not with a decision.
Well, again, we went to the police, we go to the DPW, we're trying to find, like, what are the issues? I know you raised it last month, you're raising it again, and we care about that. We just don't have what to do about it, I guess.
I have another question. So this is considered a residential development. It's in our residential district. And it was proposed as a source of revenue to offset the excessive increase in our taxes due to the town garage.
It's a source of revenue.
Correct?
The developers came to us. The town didn't seek this out.
No, I know that, but my point is so this development is undertaken, and is this considered a source of revenue for the town?
Sure. I guess that would be the way somebody perceived it.
I asked that because according to the housing production plan, residential use actually costs the town. So could this potentially really just be more of a...
Again, that's not, I've never heard anybody say that this is why the town wants it.
I'm not saying why, I'm saying is this a source of revenue for the town? I'm not saying that's its purpose.
Definitely.
Well, it's revenue, but there's expenses too. Everything has, anything with revenues has expenses usually, so...
But like the open land that's sitting there now is not an expense, according to the housing production plan.
So in other words...
But it's a question if it's lawful or not, that's...
And I'm not sure what your question is.
Costs 70 cents. And what is the residential cost for a dollar of service? Dollar taxes.
What about a one entrance solution to Sugarloaf Street? The lady is, I forgot her name, absolutely correct. It's a nut house out there. You can count all the cars you want. When you slow down to 5 miles an hour, they push you into the sign because they're going down on a commute and you're trying to turn into your driveway, okay? You gotta look at the traffic on Sugarloaf Street. It's horrendous. When it's painted four lanes, the kid could kill it.
What's the...
Okay? Second of all, going back to the water. Now, statistically, Tony said that he was going to design a plan to handle 2 100-year storms. Now, you're talking statistics, but statistically, I watched water go over Stillwater Bridge 5 or 6 years ago with a 11 to 16 inch rain. Okay? 38, 36, we had flooding in the center of town. On an acre of land, 1 foot of water of rainfall is 328,000 gallons. So that's 6 million gallons of water that's falling on that property. Now, has anybody calculated how much is going to go into the moat, the trench they're building along Mount Sugarloaf? Because that's just going to accelerate the water around the property into these shallow drainage systems, or drainage storage areas. How much water is going to come off of Mount Sugarloaf? Not underneath. You have your hole. You've studied the underground water. I have too. I know the wells. You're all wrong because that water doesn't move towards Roger anyways. How much water is coming off Mount Sugarloaf when you get a foot of water up there on the headlands? And is going to come down onto that property and swamp the drainage system prior to the water that has fallen on the property making it to the drainage system. And then where does the water go? They spoke of a spillway. The water, what's the excess water? Is it going to go into the sewer?
No.
Can you tell me, storm water, where's it going?
If it doesn't go into the pipes, if it's too much to get into the pipes, if it's going over the basin, it goes down Sugarloaf Street toward 116.
Now, we can't pump water out of our cellars because it's so hazardous. We can't pump it into the sewer, but you're going to run water down Sugarloaf Street?
You can't put water into the sewer because that is not sewage.
So you're going to let the excess water, because it's come out over there over the years. There's a drain there now. You could ask the Stakarskis. The water has gone between their barn and the Gritz's shed and come right out onto Sugarloaf Street. You have a great volume of water that's going to fall on that property. And the system that they have designed is totally inadequate for it. And who's going to pay for all these residents to put sump pumps in? Because the water is just below our cellars now. Any fluctuation in that is going to put water in our cellars. We live in an older neighborhood. We have stone cellars. We don't have the fancy drainage that they're putting around their foundations all tarred. We don't have that luxury. Okay? You're going to put water in people's cellars, and they're going to be pumping it back and forth between the houses. And these people are going to have their money in the bank, and the association's going to have it, and it's going to be the town's problem.
Thank you.
It's going to be the town's problem. And you better be careful with the variances, because you start granting them, the next guy is going to want a variance, and every cornfield will have one. And you'll have 401Bs like he threatened me with.
So what we're...
Keep granting variances.
Just to clarify, what we're trying to do through this public hearing process is to get all the information and to confirm that what they are building is adequate. And that's why we have the engineer doing the numbers on the stormwater and everything else. So,
can I make one clarification?
I guess what I'd like to clarify now is what information is missing and then what do we need for the next meeting and when the next meeting is.
Can I just make one clarification? I don't think, if I recall, I don't ever recall stating that we were designing a system for 200-year storms. Well, we're designing a system that meets your stormwater permit requirements in the Mass Stormwater Standards. That's what we've done, and I just want to make sure that that's on record.
Thank you, and that's, again, a clarification, is that we have bylaws and everything has to meet the bylaws, and that's what our job as a planning board is to the best of our ability, ensure that it does meet our bylaw standards. So what I've got here is that we want to hear from the fire and the DPW. We want to hear from, the question is, do we wait for the Mass DOT?
You can't.
There's nothing you can do.
No, they're not going to answer anything. All right.
That's right. I think.
You could maybe write a letter and ask them for some clarification.
You won't get a response.
Yeah. They do answer the phone. They're willing to talk.
Yeah, they're not going to put anything in writing.
And then, so in addition to the site plan review, we have three.
Now, do you want to ask for something from the fire department, too?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, so I'm saying the fire department and the Department of Public Works.
Yeah.
Which is our highway. That's our
highway. Highway department.
Yeah.
And the police department, you've got that?
That's our.
Yeah, we have.
Yeah.
And they're positive about it.
Okay.
So. I did get a letter from another, maybe a person who couldn't come tonight, Annalee Wolfgunner. You are here? Do you want to just quickly say anything since you've put in writing it was received on today, actually?
This is what she said. Comments rather than questions. Yeah. Is that appropriate now or not?
If it's, yeah, I can keep it.
It's 2 minutes and 20 seconds. Is that okay?
Perfect.
This letter and my statement tonight is in opposition to the proposal to build a 72-unit condominium complex at the foot of Sugarloaf Mountain. I believe this condo complex is a detriment to our town for many reasons, including the curb cut variance request puts citizens both within the complex as well as on the surrounding roads in danger. Serious traffic concerns, as we've talked about tonight, for the main roads and the adjoining roads have been raised but not adequately addressed. The cost benefits of the complex have not been examined objectively and comprehensively. Purported tax increases have not been sufficiently offset by concurrent increased costs to the town. Above ground retention ponds with standing water pose a public health safety risk that in the age of Zika could have life and death consequences. And through the destruction of fertile farmland, trees, and wildlife, this development will cause irreparable damage to the look, feel, and function of our beautiful town. I have been dismayed by the process and content of the planning board meetings that I have attended regarding this proposal. In particular, I do not trust the board's objectivity as evidenced by actions such as the leak to the developer of my previous letter, the developer's familiarity with the board, as evidenced by reciprocal first name discussions, his casual clothing, not this evening, and demeanor when appearing before the board, and most especially his audacity to demand quicker action on his request. As I've mentioned to other town boards, residents trust our town officials to follow established regulations, act responsibly and objectively after careful deliberation, and listen and respond to the concerns of residents. My trust in the planning board has been shaken through these deliberations on the condominium project. It is a dangerous, short-sighted, and greedy proposal. I implore you to reject the variance requests and deny approval of the project.
So I'd like to ask for another continuation, and we said that we might have a special meeting about this. Are we ready to set a new date?
Sure.
Anybody want to make a proposal on?
I think we already set a date of the 3rd of April for another meeting.
I'm saying another one in March.
Yeah.
Oh, in
specific
March.
To this.
Just for this one. Ideally, okay. Our 90 days is up.
About Monday, the 13th.
Doesn't mean we have to.
Monday the 13th?
Monday the 13th?
I can't make it. That's.
Max? John?
Tuesday? It'd be nice to have a full board, that's all. It's...
Well, I can't come Tuesday and Wednesday. I have finance committee meetings and select board meetings.
Okay.
16th, Thursday?
We'll start with the...
Friday, we could do the 17th.
16th, doesn't it?
South County EMS, we need an ambulance.
16th is what day of the week?
16th is Thursday.
Is that this, what Thursday is that?
Two Thursday, not this, the following.
No, is it the second Thursday, the third, what is that?
The 16th, if we do it, can we do it at 6 o'clock?
The third Thursday.
Sure.
Yeah.
I'm good with that.
And I'm okay.
I was just going to ask when your meeting starts.
Yeah, if we do it 16th at 6, that would be good for me.
All right, I'd like to...
Rachel?
I'll do my best. I'll shake it.
All right.
Make a motion.
We...
Hold on one sec.
We got to make sure all the relevant...
I'm fine with it.
These guys are kind of important.
Tony's pointing at his calendar.
16th doesn't work?
I have another ZBA hearing this 16th at 7 o'clock, but...
At a different time. I really think he should be here.
Yeah, no.
Figure it.
Monday's bad, Roger, all day? We can do it early?
Monday's...
Yeah, I could do it early. I have a meeting at 7:30. No, actually, yeah, 6 o'clock.
That'd be quick turnaround for all changes and things that needed to be...
Be long.
Right, so then you go to the 20th. All the Mondays are bad, or...
No, just the second and fourth Mondays.
So the 20th, actually, how about Monday, the 20th?
I'm not here.
Or would, could you be here for 7:30 on Monday? Would that be too much, pushing it too much?
I don't know how long the meeting will go, kid, so...
I'm not available on the 13th, so I don't necessarily have to be there, but just...
The March 20th, does that work for everyone?
That's for me.
Pat?
I'm good, March 20th.
That's a Monday night.
Yeah, that's good for a Monday. That's good for me.
It's not good for me.
You'll be gone?
And at 6 p.m., or would you go to 7?
Hold on.
A week you're gone. I mean, I don't want to make that up.
But I'm gone that whole week.
What time would you have it, John?
Gone that whole week.
I think you could ask to have it early at 6, right?
On Mondays?
Oh, that Monday, I'm fine, so...
Oh, okay. Would that be the only thing we're discussing?
Yeah.
Okay, well, I just wondered if you needed to go earlier or later or whatever.
I can come anytime.
The 13th?
20th.
20th.
Rachel can't do the 20th.
I can't do 20th.
So we're not going to have Rachel, we're not going to have Roger.
Yeah.
No, Roger, did you say the 20th is bad for you, Roger?
No, he can't be on the 13th.
But also, I think, just to be fair, not that I don't want to be there, but a quick turnaround is a quick turnaround, and the 20th may make more sense, just because then you have more information going down.
Rachel, can I ask when you're back?
I haven't gone that whole week.
For the 27th, if you could go?
I'm gone from the 19th to the following week, that whole week.
So you're back on the...
I'd be back by the 30th.
By the 30th? That's one long week, Rachel.
That's a long week.
Almost 2 weeks.
Well, wait. Let's be fair. I'm looking at the wrong one. The 27th, I'll be back.
Oh.
So then the question is, do we go to April 3rd, and whether...
I will be back.
That's on all our calendars. We're all here.
I will be back on the 27th, if you don't want to, if you don't mind going out that far back.
Do you mind if we talk amongst ourselves for a second?
Yeah. So I'm just not here the 20th. Plus, my calendar is, puts it on me. But the 13th's fast. That's all.
But what about April 3rd? I think that's fine, too.
We're in agreement that April 3rd is fine.
It's okay?
Then you don't change the schedule there.
Right.
Yep.
And we start at 6, because we might have one or two other things still.
Yeah.
All right, so we got to get some more. Sarah will finish.
I'll get here when I get here.
Catch basin business. I'll try to touch base with DOT to get some more information on that. So it sounds like, you know, water's been an issue from day one, and it's still questions about it. Safety's been an issue from day one. There's still some questions about that. We want to make it as, you know, see what we can come up with.
Okay.
The variances that we have to decide on is the...
Can I just interrupt you? They're waivers. It's very different.
Sorry. Waivers is the...
I know everybody's kind of throwing that around, but it's an important distinction.
Waivers, one is the distance between the two roads into the subdivision. The number of catch basins still is a...
Distance between them.
Spacing.
Spacing.
All right. And so, Sarah, that's something you could help us with, to see if there's any issues with that. And then the other one is the markers.
The monumentation.
Which, the monumentation of each lot. Remember, we talked about that last month. It didn't seem to be a big issue.
That was it, I believe.
All right. All right, so I'd like to, we're going to continue this public hearing for the Sugarloaf condominiums until April 3rd.
6 o'clock.
6 o'clock.
6 o'clock.
6 o'clock, April 3rd, here at the town.
Rachel, again, you're not going to be able, you won't be here at six on that meeting?
I'll try. It's just a hard day.
Thank you, every.
I've got money.
The spacing of the roads, the number, the spacing of the catch basins, and then monument markers. So thank you, everybody, for your interest in this and for coming out. And we'll see you April 3rd. With that, the planning board moves into another public hearing. So I'll give this to the, Pat, you know, I give this to Priscilla and have her.
The original needs to go to the town clerk. And then copy should go in the file and copy should go to
the. I got to say, you did an absolutely fantastic job.
Come on first. Yes, sorry.
John, what were the three things you mentioned? The monuments, the catch basins, and
the distance between the roads.
Distance between the roads. Curb cuts on Sugarloaf Street. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It's stated a little differently, but that's about it. All right, let me find the announcement for the. Come on.
Catch basins and the monuments will be our responsibility. The DOT has got the curb cuts.
No, we. It's a waiver that waiver. We, no matter what DOT says, we can approve a waiver or not.
Oh, okay.
That's my understanding.
Right.
That's my understanding.
Waiver. Okay.
We
John,
waive our local.
A, did we actually make a motion to vote on the continuation?
Yes. Oh, sorry. There's a motion. Did you second it?
John made the motion. John.
No, I need to make a motion. I make a motion that we continue this meeting, the public hearing, for the project Sugarloaf condos, I guess we're calling them, to April 3rd at 6 p.m.
I'll second the motion.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstained. Thank you for formalizing that. So notice, if you could call the town hall and ask the administrator, I think that's a town administrator issue, actually.
There are speakers up here now. How they
we control
they,
very little here, to tell you the truth.
Yeah.
We're being mic'd.
Right. So if you could make that, I can try to remember to do that. But if you could suggest it to the town administrator, that would be fantastic. I'd also like to let people know that there is this is an elected body. People can run for the planning board. I'd encourage that for people who have things to say and think that things aren't being done right. Please try to get on and do the right thing. So. I'd like to open the continuation of a public hearing. Notice is hereby given that the Deerfield Planning Board will hold a public hearing on December 5th, 2000. It started on December 5th. We're going to continue it on March 6th, Deerfield Town Hall, Conway Street, on the request of Bacon and Wilson, representing Cumberland Farms, Inc., for a site plan review pursuant to sections 5400, 2230 of the Deerfield zoning bylaws. Cumberland Farms, Inc. proposes to construct and operate a retail convenience store and vehicle filling station on property at 31 Elm Street. Assessors map 168, parcels 63 and 64. The site is currently commercially zoned at C1 and is expected to occupy 85,298 square feet of area. And copies of the site plan and the application have been available for the last couple months in the town hall. So with that, we are, this is our continuation, so we have a lot of information. I guess I'd like to ask Pat Smith from the FERCOG is our helping us with this review. Can we ask the applicants, do you have any new information? Anything we should know from previous meetings? Otherwise, we kind of want to get into what the main issues are.
Sure.
Ooh, someone turned the
mic. Well, they turned the volume. Yeah.
See, Annalee, all you have to do is ask for it.
Did you see that, Annalee?
Of course not.
So good evening, Mr. Thank Chairman, you. Members of the board. I'm Tom Reilly, I'm here with Bacon Wilson out of Amherst. Of the farms with me this evening is our site engineer Phil Henry and our traffic engineer Jason Adams. We've also got our developer Tracy Roll with TM Crowley. To answer your question, I think the last time we were here, Phil had presented kind of the concept plan of how we were revising the original plan that was submitted to you back in December. Since that time, we formalized it, we provided it all to Ms. Smith, and she has reviewed that plan in the interim. We have received approval from the Conservation Commission, both the original plan and then this revised plan. In their minutes, they accepted it as a de minimis change. And also on the 16th of February, we appeared in front of the Zoning Board of Appeals, received the special permits that we needed, as well as variances. So we're here before you with, besides the underground storage tank approval and the Mass DOT approval, we are requesting the site plan review and the stormwater permit. The site plan review also includes, by one of your footnotes, outdoor display, storage, and sales. But I think other than that, nothing has changed. We've heard positively from DPW relative to this redesign and also the police. And I think I've forwarded those emails to Ms. Smith, and if not, then I can provide them this evening. So, without more, I'll turn it over to whoever you'd like it to be turned over to.
Does planning board members have anything to say at this point, or should we follow, let Pat take a lead on this?
Go for it, Pat. Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, I've passed around to you an update of the stormwater permit and site plan review report. This has been updated over the weekend. Tom and I both worked too much. And also in talking today, made a couple of additional changes. I conclude that the provisions of section 5400, you can see on page 6 in the red, bold, italic. I conclude that the provisions of section 5400 site plan review of the town zoning bylaws have been met. And further, the permit procedures and requirements codified in section 6.0 of the stormwater regulations for the town have also been met. There's one outstanding issue in regard to the easements or agreements for maintenance that had been discussed at the last meeting. And my notes had indicated that the discussion had focused on adding a provision to the stormwater management report to allow the town that authority to do so. So Tom had suggested some language that we could use for that as well.
And that would be instead of an easement?
Yes.
Right.
Yeah, so as part of the operation and maintenance plan, which is part of the stormwater report, and that is also part of the Conservation Commission's order of conditions, we suggested putting in some language that allows the town to, but doesn't bind the town to, which I thought was an important distinction, giving an easement.
Yeah,
exactly, right. Exactly. Right. To get in, to make sure, and it's one of those things that will be self-evident. If the stormwater management system is not working as it should, you'll know it. And then having not only a piece in the operations and maintenance plan, but also conditioning the approval that we follow that operations and maintenance plan. If we don't, the building commissioner can say, listen, you're not following this. Yeah. You've got to do it, and it's either fines or a cease and desist. So I thought that gave it sufficient teeth.
I got to wearing my other hat, I'm a bit uncomfortable with any type of language that puts the town in any responsibility portion of that. It's private property.
Well, here, let me ask.
But it's private property, and that, you know, if the applicant or the landowner fails to do what they need to do, and somehow it damages the neighbors or budding property, then the person who's aggrieved by this action could not only go after them, but then could come back on the town and say, hey, you know, you had the ability to do this as well, and it's not our responsibility. The town, I mean, the people who own the property are responsible for this. If the town notices that they're neglectful and it's causing other problems, there's legal recourse for this without getting the town involved and stuff like that.
Yeah, and we would agree. We would think that having this operation and maintenance plan without putting any additional language in there would be sufficient for the town and probably alleviate right. your concerns because
right.
it would be a private right of action between the butters.
It would.
So I'm going to pass out for, in anticipation of the, they're right. getting close enough to potentially even vote on this tonight, I did also, at the request of the chair, prepare a draft stormwater permit decision. And I will know, it doesn't say draft on this, but this is a draft. So if anybody gets a copy of it, this is not the final, just so you know that. The reason I'm passing it out at this moment is I did incorporate that language into a condition which you'll find on the bottom of page 4, so you can actually see what that language is and see what kinds of authority it involves. I'm also going to pass out, so I have one remaining question while you're looking at that, and that is, you may recall that we have relied on the peer review engineer, Newton Engineering, who had been hired by CONCOM for purposes of analyzing the stormwater. So my question had come up as I was completing my reviews. Did the engineer ever see these revised plans and come back with a final analysis concluding that this current version of the plan meets the town's stormwater standards and the state's standards? And we've been unable, I tried to, again, at the urging of the chair, I did try to contact Mr. Newman today and was unable to do so. So what I have just passed out to you, kind of in lieu of that, is an email that Tom had sent me. And he goes through here the points. He makes the points that does meet the standards, and you know, he cites Phil in regard to that, and this is where he made the suggestion about the change to the stormwater management. I will be following up by making, you know, sending this to the town so it becomes a permanent part of the record. But I wanted you guys to see that so that you could determine if that is enough information for you to go ahead and vote on this project today.
Pat, on this first handout, you wanted us to look at the operations and maintenance plan?
On this decision? Yeah, on page 4.
Okay, but
that is the language that he has proposed for access for maintenance. That's why you that's why we have drafts, so that we can work
okay,
them over.
But this particular one just basically says that our agent will have the authority, but not required
but not
to,
right.
but just inspection has nothing to do with maintenance of it.
Right.
Well, it says for compliance with the plan best practices and to ensure proper functionality. So it's not saying that they would go in and just
do it. All it says is they're going to inspect it for
right.
its proper
And then that
operation.
Would set them up to do one of the enforcement actions that you have already talked about, but to catch it before it's a problem. Most communities do want to have access to the stormwater management installations as to
And isn't there a manual isn't there a book, a recording of what they're doing?
There is an inspection schedule that is included in their operations and maintenance plan and the stormwater management report, so right. that everything, you know, there is a way to record
that's
everything.
And that's ongoing. That's not just
right.
initial.
Right. Yeah. It's an ongoing.
Well, the inspection part I don't have a problem with. I just don't want the town to be liable for any maintenance, so we can't even maintain what we have of our
so
own.
So I don't, you know, we have lawyers here to answer those questions, but I don't see it setting that requirement and responsibility on part of the town, so that's why I wanted you to see it, because I don't think it goes to the level that I
No, it doesn't, but that's what it was, that's the way I took it, so I just want to make sure that
that's what I wanted you guys to see it.
Okay.
So we don't have a checklist for everything, because we've talked about this at a couple other meetings. Right, so you've got on this report what some of the issues still were.
Yeah.
Which aren't...
And, you know, as I say, they have met the site plan review requirements, and they have met the permit procedure requirements under the stormwater management, but I am not capable to comment on the actual stormwater calculations in those plans. I don't have the technical expertise. I am not an engineer. That's why I was trying to get back to Newman.
Right.
But I will say that these have been deemed to be such de minimis changes that the CONCOM didn't feel it necessary to issue another order of conditions.
Yeah.
So I would anticipate that his answer would be that it's largely no change from his earlier analysis, but I can't speak for him, and I wasn't able to reach him.
So I would just like to remind us, I think we went over these other meetings, so we had some comments from other departments. The DPW did say no issues. They said no comments. Welcome the new building. CONCOM was doing their own review, and they have now approved it. And then the police...
We did hear from police as well. I know I saw
department, and it was Sergeant Harry Ruddock from the police department. Because this is, again, the traffic is another issue on this one. Only concern is impact of additional traffic on the intersection of Greenfield and Elm Street. Mass DOT may have a look at the traffic and the light timing to facilitate this additional traffic there. Even though the applicant's traffic study, I think, found minimal impact on their traffic study, there will be an impact at this intersection. But it sounds like it was partly the traffic light, that's DOT, right?
Yeah. And one of the new pieces of information that had come in since our last meeting was an update on the traffic impact study from McMahon.
Yep.
And again, saying that it was minimal change. And she had made a presentation here at our last meeting for you in some depth.
That is what, Pat? I didn't catch that.
It was a letter updating the traffic impact study from McMahon. I forget the woman's name. I'm sorry. I apologize. But she was here at the last meeting and then had subsequently filed this letter. So they've been quite conscientious about, you know, making sure that all the materials are available for your review.
Aaron Fredette.
Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah, you see minimal change, but there will be more traffic because right now there's nothing.
You mean minimal change from what?
From the first traffic impact study to the revised plan. That doesn't address
that. Without the extra, with the third cut.
For informational purposes, I don't know if the other members of the board were aware, but two Saturdays ago, there were 157 cars illegally parked on Route 5 for the stretch from Elm Street all the way up to Red Roof Inn. Because they couldn't park in Yankee Candle's parking lot. The town dispatched two cruisers to deal with the traffic, and there was no incidents. I just thought I'd let you know.
Thank you.
Sure.
Interesting. So that's right across from where this...
Yep.
Right across from where this is being proposed.
Mm-hmm. What I'm saying is, my point is that there was an abundance of vehicles over there, and, you know, the town did have to dispatch two cruisers, but there was no incidents.
I'm sorry, Greg Newman Engineering is the Newman Environmental Engineering, I think, technically.
And no changes needed.
We have not heard from him.
But we assume that it's CONCOM.
We can't assume it. Well, CONCOM approved it, but I don't. We have nothing back from the engineer.
Yeah, okay. All right. There you go.
So I can't make any assertions.
So any other questions?
The curb cut on Route 5, have you been issued that?
No, we have not. We need to get all of our local approval before we can get a Mass DOT access permit. So we've had preliminary discussions with them and have shared the plans, including the updated plan, with the Mass DOT District 2 office. They're generally in agreement that things will be fine, but they won't complete their final technical review until after we've received local approvals. And at that point, they would work to issue the access permit.
So this is what still confuses me.
Yeah, I frankly don't understand that.
I can't vote on this with a yes vote until we know that MassDOT approved that. So that's kind of the chicken and the egg type thing.
Right, but if you vote yes and then they come back and say no, then we're back in front of you.
You would have to come back here.
We have to come back in front of you with a revised plan.
But does our yes vote potentially make them feel like, oh, it's okay with the town's approving the curb cut?
Right. Oh, the town, we don't have any liability. The town said yes.
But they still have to. I mean, this is a road that actually starts, for all intents and purposes, as far as I'm concerned, in Waitley. I'm sure it starts someplace else.
Yes.
But when I get off of exit 24, I'm in Waitley. So, I mean, it's not, they're looking at the whole stretch of road.
Right.
They care about us, but they also care about all the people that live in Greenfield. And
right, and that's why they should decide first.
Well, yeah, but they'll, well, I mean, I hear you. I get you.
I could speak to the process a little bit if you like. So from the MassDOT perspective, they wouldn't want to spend their resources working to approve a project that was not received at the local level. So that's, I mean, it is a chicken or the egg, but from the state, over the course of management of all of their roadway system, they don't want to spend all those resources if the project was not going to live at the local level. So that's how they see it. And so they'll sit down and we can have a preliminary review. We can get their feedback, which we have. But once you've approved it, if you choose to approve it, we would then get the formal permit from MassDOT. And like Tom said, if at that point they said you can't access it at this point, you know, we can't continue to move forward with the project. So
they're certainly going against past practices. There's been multiple curb cuts requested, and they never came to the town and said, hey, what's your thought on this process? They just denied the people right out flat. Mm-hmm. So it's a little bit hard to believe that they're just not making a decision on their own. Why are they waiting for us?
This is a little bit of a unique stretch of road, Greenfield Road, because there is a no access line for MassDOT. So there is a little bit of precedent to deny additional curb cuts to the area.
That's why everybody's wondering.
Right, and then so that is still a process that we need to go through, and we need to work through that process with MassDOT. We've been out on the site with District 2, who is, again, in favor of a project such as this, the impact that this would have versus another type of use, the location of the access points, and all of that. So they're generally in favor of this being an appropriate use for this site, but we do still have a couple hurdles to get through at the state level, but we can't proceed with that until we know that the project is well received at the local level.
So, Pat, anything else on your?
Those are the two.
So they've met all the things in our site plan review. Mm-hmm.
So then, assuming that you're comfortable with what information we have in regard to the stormwater management plan here, then I have in this draft decision here provided some sample conditions that you might put on it. We already discussed that operation and maintenance one in regard to stormwater permit. For the site plan review, typically you would just have a general provision that states the plans, so that the applicant shall construct according to these plans. Mm-hmm. I added number four, within 60 days of completion of construction of the project, applicant shall submit as-built drawings, as you're allowed under your stormwater permit regulations to require that, and that I think is handy for the building commissioner to have that for future reference. The general one is in regard to nuisances and set some time frames on when the work can be done. Then obviously violation number two is a violation of any condition contained herein is a zoning enforcement, subject to zoning enforcement. So it's pretty simple. The final one on page five is in regard to the certificate of completion that is required under the stormwater regulations. So this just says that it just lays out what those requirements are so that everybody is aware that that has to happen, which is that Once the project is completed, they certify that it is done in accordance with the plans, and there is an opportunity for inspections to document that compliance, and then your board would be asked to issue a letter certifying completion. So it's pretty straightforward.
Good. So this is a public hearing, so is there any comments or questions from anybody in the public about the Cumberland Farms project on Elm Street? So.
I had just one more comment in regard to this conditions. There's a little bit of an issue with the timing of the various boards' reviews of the plans, because according to your zoning bylaws, any conditions that you put on your site plan review have to be included in the special permit that's issued by the ZBA. So they have already issued their permit. I haven't seen a copy. I don't know if you guys, I've asked a couple of times. So we don't know what's in there, but you, whatever conditions you put, and these are fairly simple ones, would ultimately have to somehow make it back. They have to be on the plans, and they have to ultimately be included into that special permit.
No problem.
All right, so that's kind of a town logistical timing thing. That,
you have a...
Yeah. That's come up before. Yeah. And multiple boards.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes? We've been told things. It's not relevant to this, but we've been told they're going to take out the they have to take out the gas tanks and sell the site. Is basically.
Did we hear anything else? But I think they said that they would not be sold for retail use like it's got now.
Deed restrictions.
There are some deed restrictions.
The deed restrictions on what it can be used for.
Previous meetings, we have certainly encouraged them that we don't want that to be a vacant, ugly vacant space in the middle of town. I'm not sure that's not something. Is that a condition we can put on?
No, I don't think so.
But why not? I mean, maybe it's not.
Well, because they can't control the real estate market. That would be, there's too many unknowns that it would be controlling that, not them. I think, you know. You could potentially put in conditions about the condition that they leave
that's
it in.
That's what I'm thinking, yeah.
But not as, right. as to
the
its
condition they leave it in
sale.
Is definitely without, it has to be cleaned up.
But
the,
again, that property isn't before you.
Right. I know. I mean, so it isn't before you, but I think as a practical matter, and as timing would work out, should this be approved, once this is constructed, then the other one will come offline, the tanks will be removed with a licensed site professional watching the removal, the site will be cleaned, and then we've got some leads on some different people in the area who may be interested in purchasing it. So it behooves us just as much as it behooves the town, and Dick Kalashevsky has been fantastic to work with on this. To make sure it's not empty. I mean, it's not good for you, it's not good for us.
Right.
And John, would it be appropriate here to mention that there's recordings of all these meetings that we've had, so if anybody doesn't come to the meetings, can always go on and review these things for their, so they know ahead of time rather than you know, duplicating for people that didn't come to the meetings.
Good point. But the question is, we can't, it's all kind of hearsay, some of the stuff. We have no control over what happens to the other.
Oh, no, I'm just talking in regards to the fact that some people didn't hear what went on in previous open hearings.
You're talking
about the general public. I'm talking about anybody.
Could you just quickly, this just reminded me about the connection to downtown. What did you do with the sidewalks? How's the final plan?
So
we talked about that last month, I know. But.
Yeah, I think one of the requests at the first planning board was to introduce a sidewalk coming from downtown.
Yeah.
So what we did is we've committed to proposing a sidewalk along the entire Elm Street frontage, which was on the original plan.
Good.
And then cut in an internal sidewalk and pedestrian access to the outdoor seating area. There's a side entrance here and there's a front entrance here. So there is some pedestrian connectivity.
That makes it as connected to the downtown as it can be. Yes.
Well, hopefully the town can step in. There's like 150 feet to connect it.
With no sidewalk.
With no sidewalk.
So there is a sidewalk on the other side.
There is.
Yeah.
All right, good. Anything else?
Because that would prevent crossing.
But didn't we find out, John, at the last meeting that that there's no crossing of the tracks on that side of the...
There is.
There's sidewalk.
Well, there is, okay. I thought the last time we said there wasn't.
I think I said that, but I was wrong.
Okay.
So it'd make it a lot safer for pedestrians if hopefully the town will step in afterwards and put that in.
Comments, motions?
Well, I make a motion that we approve their site plan package as it was presented tonight. Now, do we do the site plan separate from the stormwater report?
I was going to just check, does it matter?
I put them on the same document just for simplicity's sake, but it probably isn't a bad idea for you to vote them separately.
Okay.
And I would just, one point of clarification for the site plan, your footnote 5 to the table of uses allows outdoor storage, sales, or display associated with any retail use, and that requires site plan review. So we've got that special permit from the Zoning Board of Appeals, so we would just like this to mimic not only
the use. So you want to reflect that outdoor retail use?
Yes. And it, I mean, ice, windshield washer fluid, sure, firewood, if you're familiar with some of the other sites, what's outside, that's sure, what would be outside.
And that was part of the special permit? That's what you're
also, yes, but your the way your zoning bylaw tracks
it. It's a trigger
tracks,
for site plan review.
Precisely.
So that, I just want to make sure we roll that. I can adjust, it's more for the report to adjust that as a reason than it is to actually comment on it in the decision, I think.
Yes.
Well, they have tables outside.
Excuse me?
They have tables outside.
Yeah, but that's not what
that's
it was
sales
about.
Yeah, we're so what just are you talking about?
Like firewood, for example, sometimes they'll have the firewood outside, sometimes they'll have the windshield washer
right,
fluid outside.
And what about ice?
Ice, for yeah, example. And I don't know where the market is going to go with this stuff,
right,
but that's just...
Well, you have
pretty,
ice at the
minimal,
current one. That's why I'm saying.
That's, and I would expect it to continue, or maybe the inside's large enough so they can keep the ice inside. I don't know
yeah,
where it's going
okay,
to go.
Gotcha.
So just belt and suspenders approach is what we're taking.
I'll second it.
Okay. So that was that's this is for the
site plan review.
Any discussion?
No.
So the or maybe this is more about the stormwater, but should any condition be that we hear back from our engineer?
I know that's just the I don't think it's fair to them to you know to require them to compel that
right,
communication with the town.
I'm sure the conservation commission.
Well, so we're basically going with the contract.
Yeah. You're going on faith, but it's a pretty good case.
And the change was
for going on. The change was fairly. Yep. All
right. And traffic, we did not do a full blown traffic study with that one from the applicant. Any more discussion?
No, I'm still a little weirded out about the curb cut from MassDOT, but whatever.
Uh-huh. All right, so we have a motion and a second to approve the site plan review for 31
now,
Elm Street.
We actually, they should say that we accept the site plan review. Is that what it says? Or
motion
what is the
accept.
Actual word? Wording should it be?
I think it's to approve.
To approve, okay.
Let me double check.
Yeah, approval shall be granted. So
yeah.
We would suggest
approve.
Approval.
Okay, I'm just trying to get the right.
Okay,
right.
Good.
So we have a motion to, and
make,
a second to approve. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstain?
700.
So what's
700.
No, with the stormwater?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I make a motion that we accept the stormwater provisions.
I think what you're going to do here is issue the stormwater permit.
Issue. I make a motion we issue the stormwater permit for 31 Elm Street.
I'll second that.
Any more discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? Wow. 700.
Thank you very much.
Pretty impressive.
We appreciate it.
Just one more thing to get the wording correct.
She's got it in this document that
so then the very last thing would be, I think, maybe to actually approve the decision with the conditions in it, you know, as presented. So maybe a third vote for that would cover all bases, get you back around.
So what was that? An approval of all?
To accept the decision with...
With conditions.
As written with the conditions as presented.
The one dated March 7th on the top here.
Okay, I make a motion that we accept the conditions and...
We just accept the decision as written.
The decision as written. And what was that date you said?
Just accept the decision. It temporarily says March 7 on it because I was putting that, that's highlighted. You can't see that, but that was just a tentative one for purposes of hopefully getting it done quickly.
So we need to vote. Paul, do you second that?
I'll second it, yeah.
Discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed, abstained?
Okay.
Passes.
Thank you very much. We appreciate it.
All right, thanks.
Good luck.
So I'll be working with you guys quickly to finish up the final report and get this decision out to you. You could actually, if you guys want, to go ahead and sign this back sheet. I always put that on a single page so that I could get that from you now and then finalize everything.
And these things, we don't need a we don't need Mylars in the business? Is this
no.
It's instead we're doing this?
Do you guys want a copy of this?
I'll get it to them once it's all done. They have it already in this form. I
with
gave
our
it to
sign,
them.
With
yeah, they signing. Will get that when it's done. If you want to sign it, then I'll finalize it.
Okay. And what's the, you've got the date of the most recent one?
Yeah, I have all the plans. They were excellent about making sure that I had all of the plans along the way.
Number.
And you can look at the dates on these emails. The Everybody's working too hard.
How many
Saturday,
can you do?
Sunday.
The actual
we can work on it. I'll make a note. Sure. Let me make a note to that effect here.
Do you know about how many originals? We just need the one?
Yeah, just sign one original, and I'll work from there.
All right. Are they signing it?
Yeah, and then we'll come back. All right, good job. Thanks.
So one down.
Where's the agenda?
Okay, see.
For Greenfield Road, do we have
to where?
Folks interested in talking about that? I will find the public hearing announcement on that.
The way I drive, it's definitely. Oh, nice. Nice. Perfect.
I think, Paul, you're the clerk. You have a special line to sign.
Oh, okay.
Otherwise,
all right.
Otherwise everybody...
yeah, I guess I do have a clerk line here.
Very official.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, we're getting the money's worth out of Pat.
Oh, boy. I got emails on Saturday and Sunday from her. It's pretty good. All right, I'd like to open the continuation of a public hearing. Notice is hereby given that the Deerfield Planning Board will hold a public hearing January 3rd, February 6th, and continued on March 6th at the Deerfield Town Hall, 8 Conway Street, on request of New England Patient Network for a site plan review pursuant to Sections 5400 and 2230 of the Deerfield Zoning Bylaws. New England Patient Network proposes to rebuild an existing house on property at 4 Greenfield Road, Assessor's Map 175, Parcel 8, for use as a medical marijuana dispensary. The site is currently zoned commercial 3, which I believe is industrial in our...
Yeah.
Goes both ways.
Yeah.
Copies of the plans have been available at the town hall for inspection during regular business hours. So this is the third time we're... we're discussing this project, and we see some familiar faces.
Yeah, just wondering, I could I have your name again, sir?
Nick Spagnola.
Oh, Nick Spagnola, and then the only guy
I'm know. Phil Silverman. I'm an attorney for New England Patient Network.
Bill Silverman?
Phil, yep.
That maybe one of your cards before you leave. This is your first time here, right?
It is.
Yeah, okay.
So we know... we know something about the project. Can you just give us any highlights of any changes or any updates from the last
Well, we made a few revisions to the plan based on the draft report from the peer reviewer from Pat's work. Submitted that back to her and to the town. There's an updated set of drawings. We also supplied a conceptual rendering of the house as it will be constructed from the outside.
Actually, do you want to maybe just point, walk us through? You've got the plans there. You want to just give us a quick?
Yeah, there's only a few few things that we changed. Couple things that came out in the draft report from Pat was lack of snow storage, loading, trash area, and last time we did give you photometrics and lighting. So we're going to add two street light standards in the parking area. We have wall-mounted packs to the building. The hatched area shows the snow storage area. And then back here, when you come through the secondary gate, this is a loading area, and we're showing some trash enclosures here. This area will be screened by a solid stockade vinyl fence. The rest of it is the chain link fence. It'll be vinyl coated. We call out color black right now, but it could be changed to green or something that's more comparable with the exterior of the building. But I just wanted the board to know that it is a vinyl coated chain link. It won't be galvanized. And I think those were the only changes that we made to the plans. And just to update you, we don't have a permit for the driveway at this point. It has been approved locally, District 2, and is off to Boston. Boston has to approve any changes to the state highway layout that has a no access designation at this point. So that could take some time. And so what we'd be asking this evening, if we believe we've satisfied the site plan review criteria, so we'd be asking for conditional approval from the board this evening.
So Pat's laid out a lot of the issues in her memo here, so maybe we can go right through all of them.
Yeah, I mean, really, it's exactly what Tony has already said. The review of the specific zoning bylaw provisions begins on page 7. So again, here I have added in red italic bold font my comments in response to what I have received back. And they've either actually changed the plans or have given enough information on the question. So for example, fire protection, they're not putting them on the plans now, but they've given you some additional information about plans to sprinkle, potentially how that might happen. And again, pointing out the connection to the main is in MassDOT's hands because that's where it is in there right away. So you will see a lot of red, but that just means that they provided a lot of information in response, and I have now deemed them all to be met. There were some additional input that had been provided from the Whately Planning Board, who came and spoke to you at your last meeting, and I reviewed their letter and have addressed a couple of items. If you look on page 8, G and H, that refers to trees, plantings and screenings, and G and H is exterior lighting. And while it is somewhat outside of your purview, I have noted for your information here the Department of Public Health regulations in regard to how those issues have to be handled at a registered marijuana dispensary. Just so, well, again, you're not issuing the special permit from the that's the Board of Selectmen's job. But again, your site plan review regulations typically ask for screenings and different lighting formats, and I wanted it to at least be out in front of you that you didn't want to put conditions on here that would be in violation of the DPH regulations for the proposed use. So those I did add a little bit of information in regard to those matters in that area. But overall, it's my conclusion, as is shown on page 6, that they have met the provisions of Section 54.
So can you tell us a little more about the lighting, why it's all, doesn't have, you have to get the wording
full cutoff down lighting.
Stays on site, or?
Yeah, it's downcast. We give a couple of different fixture units there and supply the board with the photometric plan for that. And it's not excessive. It has to be there for security purposes, but it's, if you look at the photometrics, there's no significant light cast across the property.
I managed to not get a copy of those. I saw them last month, but I didn't end up with a copy, hard copy of those. So if you could send me those digitally, that'd be great, so that I can make sure that they're on this list in the final form. I've been working on a few of these projects. I might have put it in the wrong file folder, so I apologize.
Not a problem.
So I'll just, I think I mentioned some of these at the last meeting. We got feedback from our Board of Selectmen. The Selectmen supports this project. It appears to be of low impact. Highway Superintendent says no issues. Police Chief just wants to make sure there's the right exterior lighting, including the building and the parking lot. He talks about cameras. I think that's more for the security of the, because of the usage.
Those, again, are required by the
state.
Right,
and then a vault for overnight storage of product, secure access delivery area, secure security system, panic alarm. So those aren't so much planning board
things.
No,
they're interior to the building.
And then I actually, after some of the meetings, there was a lot of discussion about traffic. I asked the police to look, the police department to take another look at it and to give us their impact, their assessment of the traffic along there and turning and everything. And so if I can read what we received on February 17th from the police chief. I did go out and measure and spend time at the proposed medical marijuana dispensary site. I'm monitoring traffic there for hours, more specifically looking at the use of the turning lane southbound in the Sugarloaf shops. In order to get a curb cut from MassDOT, one of the safety engineers has to sign off on it. They are a far greater expert than I could ever pretend to be, so if they authorize it, I believe the potential safety issues have been mitigated. However, again, I do not believe there is a problem with either entering or exiting the newly proposed curb cut. I certainly would recommend traffic lights at routes 5 and 10 in Conway Street. And he says it sometimes looks like a disaster at school time. At Route 5 and 10 at North Main Street, Route 116 at River Road, and quite frankly, in the center of town. But those are other projects a little bit separate from this, I guess. Okay. So that's what we received back from the police about the traffic there and the turning, the safety issues. Is anybody here from Wheatley? Wheatley Planning Board? Anybody else from the public? This is a public hearing. Anybody would like to comment on this? Good evening.
I would like to comment.
Thank you, Mark. We corrected your, in the minutes from last month, we got your name wrong, but we corrected the spelling. So we will try to get it right tonight.
Okay.
You want to just say who you are? And
so I'm Mark Malone. I'm a property owner to the north on 5 and 10. And I have had some work done from Terry Remitz, who's also a civil engineer, did the study of the plan that was...
Can't hear you.
The plan that was put forth by Tony and SVE. So I have copies of.
Thank you so much.
You can pass along. Them
pass so these along. Gentlemen have one too? You need
to get one for that. I got one for each of you.
These are any of these public documents that are given, you know, to the board also should be given to applicants.
Or have a copy of
it? Yeah, so we can't just, Mark, just read this tonight necessarily. So can you give us a summary of it or read it? Or
there are.
I mean, we'll put it into the file, but just as far as.
They'd like to hear. So
You want to look at what you're doing?
We can let these bike share with you on Park Street.
Peter, we can turn this around, you can hear.
So there are abundant technical issues with the site proposal, which I'm sure some of them are already have been addressed, Patricia, through your, is it Patricia?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, through your meeting with Tony since the last time and what's come up since then. So a lot of them have already been addressed. But I just wanted to bring up a couple that I didn't hear addressed tonight that seemed to be significant. One of which is pedestrian access. There seems to be no pedestrian access to the site on the site plan. It seemed that that would be certainly a requirement as people are coming from the bus stop across the street. And this is a medical use, so a lot of the people that are coming for this are not going to be able to be driven in. So it would have to have access to the site. And the pedestrian access, also the security of the pedestrian access, that not to say that we need a security plan at this point, it's only the site review, but there should be some accommodation of how are the pedestrians accessing the property and the building. As a matter of fact, as I see, there really isn't any entrance at all proposed.
Are you talking entrance, what do you mean?
From the road to get to the building.
There's a driveway.
Oh, so no pedestrian access, huh?
It's an industrial area, wouldn't it? I mean, there's no sidewalks.
But it's not proposed for an industrial use. This is a change in going to be an industrial use.
Well, Mr. Chairman, if I could, I had actually raised this question and had designated that issue as partially met. It's on page 9 under 5462. The response back from the applicants was that there are no pedestrian facilities within that right-of-way. So there's nothing for them to connect to, so no need to provide those pedestrian facilities along the new drive. They did address pedestrian circulation and ADA accessibility on the site itself, but that was their response, and that seemed to make sense to me.
There's no way we could propose sidewalks even if we wanted to, because it's all state-owned and controlled property.
So you
even
could make them
mandate.
Put sidewalks in, but they wouldn't connect
they couldn't.
Up to anything.
Well, we could make them put sidewalks to the edge of the parking lot, but
right.
That's it. Yeah.
So. I'm just asking about
but
the
it,
proposal.
Was addressed. It was talked about.
The proposal
I know
of
that.
The site has no access from the pedestrians that are going to be coming from the bus stop, which is across the street. It's something you might want to consider. The other one is that the proposed medical use of the property would require that there is a parking space for every 150 square feet of building, which would require 14 parking spaces, but they've only proposed 10. So I didn't know if they were going to put a change in the bylaws or a new bylaw for the proposed use, or what they were going to do about the amount of parking spaces for this.
This is
I don't know if Tony had
issues.
Come up with
this
that, if there's an issue.
Entirely separate section of the zoning. It has nothing to do with medical issues.
Well, parking is something that we look. Parking
absolutely.
Is part of the
yeah.
site plan review.
Right. Absolutely. But it has nothing to do with medical issues.
What is the proposed use?
Commercial?
It's a medical marijuana
dispensary.
Facility. It's an entirely
and
separate
what is the proposed parking for medical marijuana?
I'll address the board if they would like me to address something. I'm not going to address.
Well, no, I guess what I do want to know is there is parking requirements for certain size buildings, right? Mm-hmm. That's what we look at on the planning yeah. board, and I think Pat's going to tell us something about that soon.
No, I'm trying to dig up where that is
that. If there's other requirements for medical marijuana, that's when the select board has to get involved.
I understand about the select board. I'm only trying to focus on the
right.
planning board and the site review. Right. And if you look at all of the issues in the letter that's been drafted by Terry, they're all relating to the site, and none of it is particularly relating to the select board. That's a different meeting.
I will bring up at the last meeting, or even it might have been at the first meeting, the estimated use of the parking was 4 to 6 customers an hour. So 10 parking spaces is more than adequate for that. Expected use.
But what we're saying is this
the parking and loading requirements are in section 3100 on page 179:16 of your zoning bylaw, if you have them available. So these are set out as a principal use on the left-hand side and a minimum number of parking spaces required down the right-hand side. Of course, registered marijuana dispensary is not specifically on this list. So it's not unreasonable to look at medical office potentially as a surrogate, except for, as the applicants have pointed out, it's not going to be the kind of typical medical office that we think of that has people coming and going all the time. Sort of these RMDs, difficult to say exactly what their status is in terms of how that use could be determined. So
is it retail?
General retail is 1 to 250. Right. So it's a lot.
So what is it now if you go to the square footage?
Yeah, what is it per square foot with what you
What's the square footage? Time?
The new square footage is what?
Well, 10 spaces at 1,400 square feet.
There's a proposed is 2,070.
It's about 2,000, yeah. It's just over 2,000 with the new addition, right?
2,057.
2,057 divided by 250.
But
so that means they'd need 8 parking spaces.
Mm. How many?
That includes
eight.
Garage and everything. By 250, you use the retail.
General retail.
General retail.
If you use the medical office, it might be a little bit.
It's not a medical office.
They don't have medical degrees.
No. There's no doctors.
General office.
Every town that has these bylaws for medical marijuana has come up with a exact usage, but Deerfield has left it. They don't have an amount of parking spaces required.
Correct.
And last time it was not determined that this was going to be a recreational facility. It was proposed that it was going to be strictly a medical facility. That was what was proposed by the applicants at the last hearing. It was only a month ago. They said, this will strictly be a medical facility. So as a medical facility, you would think you might want to consider that it would follow the medical use, which is 150. That would require 14 parking spaces.
The applicant explained at length what the typical visit was from a patient. It just doesn't translate over to what you want it to be. It's not that simple. The engineer designed a plan for parking with the space for the intended use and the number of patients that were expected per hour. So I feel like we've complied fully with what was asked.
All right, so that's something for us to look at.
But it doesn't comply for medical use.
Right.
So
So they're not patients, they're clients.
Other than that, there's, like I said, there's another 19 things that are really just related to the engineering that should be reviewed before you further decide what you're going to do about this. The site review. Some of them are related to the parking, some are related to the pedestrian access, some are the lighting, which I heard you talking about today, about the lighting, power, sewer, culverts, stormwater, and this stuff. This plan, just so you know, Terry has reviewed the most recent plan that was on display here as of last week. So if something new came in that's new review, then we could do that again. But we reviewed everything that was available as of last week.
I believe, Tony, you had dropped off those revised plans last week.
And Terry,
did you know?
And any questions that Terry had, he talked with Patricia directly to make sure that they had things that were covered.
He did contact me, and I documented that for the board as well.
Had already been taken off.
That's on here.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
So now, what are we going to do to get these to the gentleman here at the table?
We gave one over there. This does not, we do not require stormwater.
That was a decision that was made after a review of the issues in regard to the area within the MassDOT right away. We discussed that the disturbed area is approximately 11,000 square feet on the site itself. So that does not meet your trigger of 12,500 required for that permit. If you were to include this area? I think that it would, and that was one of the things that I had spoken to Mass DOT about, and their indication to me, and this was before our meeting last month, was that they would agree that this area not be included as long as the storm water flows from the other part of the property were not being managed in that area. Mm-hmm. Were that the case, they said it would make sense then for it to be included. But when that issue was raised at the last meeting, Tony had indicated that in fact everything, all the stormwater management is happening within this site, and this is going to be looked at as a separate system by MassDOT.
That's not accurate. Tony's plan here actually has flows shown in here that are going into state right away. All of this flow from here down goes into the state right away. Hmm. Okay. And as a project as a whole, typically, when you're looking at stormwater, it's the project as a whole. It's the impact. And it's based on the nepotism permitting. And then this town of Deerfield has developed their own. And that's how this has been generated. So this as a whole project impacts 14,000 square feet. And that's what you should be looking at.
Well, as Pat said, the Mass DOT says that if their section is, if it's, there's no water coming from the property into their property, then they consider you don't have to count.
They thought it made sense to not count under those circumstances. So, but that's an open question, something that, you know, the additional information could suggest, like that. So maybe Tony needs to respond as to whether how those flows were.
District 2 office has already approved the driveway cut. It's off the Boston Review. They don't have any issues. We made minor revisions to the driveway, and they had no issues with drainage. Nothing was ever brought up.
But I thought they did say that if all the water was staying on site and not going into their place,
where did that come
from?
Include,
then you don't have to include
that's
their
what
property.
I spoke to Jay Ely when I was asking him this question. What did he think about this issue? That was his response to me.
Well, they got the same submittal, and we have no comments back from them. Right. He told me that District 2 has approved it, and it was off to Boston for that.
Right, but they're not looking at stormwater management.
Of course they are.
Sure they are on their part.
Of course they are.
For the whole site?
No,
they're concerned about what's happening in their
right of way. Our bylaw is about the above 12,500 square feet, right?
Yeah, it's a town.
If you include the whole area, then it's about...
Then you need a stormwater permit.
That's what I'm just wondering.
Well, I mean, we stated that beginning that we did not include the right of way within the state, and that driveway and that work was state, and we said that we feel that we are not required to do stormwater permitting in a town because we're on site, we're less than 12,500. Although I did tell you that it wouldn't matter anyways because we designed the thing in accordance with it.
Right.
So, you know, we're just beating the bushes here. That's all I'm telling you. We've got a site plan that we've presented last time. We've made changes according to peer review, and it's a good site plan, and it conforms to the site plan review requirements. And it's our opinion we do not need a stormwater management plan for this or permit.
So can I go back and, I don't know, it's you or I'd like to address the owner, I guess, and why is the driveway necessary? Why not use the existing access point?
Well, we don't have legal rights over that driveway. I mean, Dan, you can talk about that. We use it right now, but there's the easement is to the west of it, and there's no driveway to the west of it. We have easement over...
There is a gore between the road and that driveway.
Sure. There's an easement right here, but there's no physical address,
correct.
Physical connection there. We have easement over this 30-foot right away.
To the extent you turn off of the main road into the Sugarloaf Shops, that is not, there's no legal easement or right of access to this property from that. It's been utilized for years that way. But from a legal standpoint, there is an island there that would block legal
because your original plan actually had that.
Right. And then the issue came up.
And then the Waitley Planning Board sent us a letter saying they, and I'm not sure why, but they thought that was better than the current.
The owner of the property feels that it's necessary to have a new new driveway opening, and that's why they've gone to MassDOT to get that access permit.
I have a question. Before the Sugarloaf Shops were built,
That house was there prior to the sugar loaf shops. So what did they use as a driveway?
Well, there's a suggestion that they had access from 116. I'm not familiar with the history on that property, but I was aware of that fact. But somehow they traveled all the way across essentially where the front of the sugar loaf shops were, or it was a contiguous, that piece of land may have been owned by the owner of the red house, or I don't know. But there's only been historical, just the title search clearly showed those.
I'm just saying, the house has been there, and I think they had access on Divide and 10. Then you go across, that was like a hayfield or backland, and it wasn't the same owners.
Yeah.
So I just wondered.
That was developed in 1981, and I used to, I went to that house for vegetables prior to that, so.
There was a driveway.
There was a driveway.
Yeah, that's why I'm asking, how did they,
but I don't know.
There was no legal, yeah. So I don't know.
Yeah. I don't know if it just had been used as essentially a permitted use, but there's no legal access there that we can establish.
So, I guess one question is, do we have enough information? What's the board think?
For
moving forward on this?
I don't see any real problems with it. I mean, it's such a small parcel of land. You know, they're doing a lot more work than necessary. I don't see an issue with it.
What work are they doing more than necessary?
Well, they're putting in all that stormwater or catch basin retention area under the parking lot that's technically not required. I mean, you know, I've gone there through a lot of rainstorms and stuff just to kind of see, and, you know, they're improving that whole situation. And I don't know.
If you review this site plan review report that's been compiled, I mean, it was one of the cleanest site plan reviews that I've seen at this point. The word met was...
Right. They were minor details that I found. But I don't look at the technical aspects, sure. So I'm just looking at the regulatory review. Sure. And the board did not get a peer review engineer to review this. So now, you know, we are hearing from somebody, and, you know, we have some materials in front of us that might warrant some time to review that.
Well, I'm a little confused, and it really pertains to this project a little bit. But we just had one where MassDOT wouldn't grant a curb cut till we made our final decision.
Right.
But in this case, they already gave them supposedly a curb cut.
And well, they got the local.
They have not given us a curb cut. It's to Boston because it's right now there's a no access through the sideline of that right of way.
Yeah.
Okay, you have to go. Anytime a state highway layout has that designation, it has to go to Boston to get cleared. So the physical improvement of the driveway and that has been approved by District 2. The permit engineer has told me that. It's in Boston now so that they could review it. There might be some legal paperwork and some survey plans that remove that portion of the driveway from no access, and that takes some time. So that's why.
But that process wasn't hinging on our us.
Oh, no, it has nothing to do with it.
That's why I just want to clarify. No. This seems odd a little bit.
No.
Paul, issues?
Well, I saw Terry's hand up.
I told him I was going to come. I was finished.
I guess I don't. I'm not totally clear on it, but I guess I'm okay.
Rachel?
Yes, I have issues. But my issues are more general, not the met is very good. So I just feel like that's a lot of cuts right there. We're suddenly looking at a sequence of cuts.
No.
And respectfully to our police chief, I don't feel like, I feel like it's a very limited project. Like we're talking about a limited project. It's a lot of investment in a small project, and it just seems like a lot of, as Kip says, a lot of fuss over a small project. But the curb cut's one of those big fusses. I don't understand why there has to be another curb cut. I feel like it's very obvious that there's another option, but.
Yeah. John?
No comment.
Max, any issues? So I guess that's, so mine is also the, I know I've been on the board for 10 years now, and one of the things we talked about was, you know, 5 and 10, not letting it become like King Street in Northampton or Federal Street and too many cuts. Like, that's appropriate
that's
some
Route
places.
9.
And
Route 9.
Or Route 9 and some other places. So I'm just, and as it's so close to the other one,
other ones.
That I would just really wonder why the applicant couldn't figure out a way to use the current one. You're telling me, this is the first time I heard that it's not, there's never a legal access point.
Right. So, I think if, to your point, John, you know, if, even if I was to agree with it, that building is there. It has been there. They're not substantially changing it at all.
No, but right, there's more people traveling there. It's more of it. And I mean, I'm not fussing too much with you, Kip. I'm just saying it is a change, and it's a change very close to already existing. So it's just kind of creeping along. And we're talking about a lot of curb cuts every time I drive down that road. I think, boom, 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 boom. So we're in one night, we've got three more cuts, when there are already one, two there before you get to the People's Bank.
Right, but it's still the state that's reviewing this.
I hear you. I mean, met. Yeah. As Dan says, it's very clean. So I'm kind of registering my own from the other side of the, I'm registering my own public concern.
I'm thinking out loud.
Okay. And I'm just saying that is with reserve.
I would just also remind the board that this was the main concern of the Whately Planning Board in the letter that they with you.
Yes.
Yeah. You had a comment, one line?
Yeah, I just a couple things. I had questioned why you've got a delivery area, you know, and I assume the security area where common trucks or delivery trucks would come into that gated area, why that's not being improved. You've got an existing gravel driveway that's going to be driven on. Do we know has it been investigated what that is? Is it adequate for this kind of vehicle to be driving in and out, or is it going to turn into a big rutted mess? It seems strange that it's not being paid or something when you're putting a commercial use in. One thing I didn't see and I was confused about was the sewer service. I didn't see that anywhere on the plan. Where is the sewer service?
I would defer to Tony. I think
an existing septic will be utilized, and the owner of the property wants to keep that gravel. He doesn't feel necessary. The public area where the customers will come to, they felt that that would be necessary to pay, and we have to provide ADA access there. But his intention was not to to pave the back area. In his feeling, it was not necessary.
And these are armored vans. They're not your typical big armored truck that would be utilized in the site.
They're not even armored, quite frankly. The Department of Public Health regulations, what they actually want you to do is to have a nondescript vehicle that you wouldn't otherwise know is carrying this. So it's generally going to be something, it could be a car or a very small van. Yeah, the type of delivery that you're talking about is generally in a pretty small box. It's not a major loading and unloading type of an operation. It's not a truck. It's really pretty minimal.
Oh, and then there's the unloading of cash the other direction, too.
Yes. Again, though, pretty minimal.
All right, board, what do we do?
I guess I would ask Pat what she feels. For my.
Well, Pat's not on.
She
helps us out a real lot.
She's the one that reviews these things.
Right, and she gave us all her stuff right here.
Right, I am not competent to answer the technical questions or to address the review. Mr. Reynolds has more expertise in that area than I, so I, you know, certainly would be interested in reviewing his letter more carefully. I will, since you have asked me, I will say though that, you know, given the press of all of the other work that had to be done, I do not have a draft decision for your review on this, and you have liked to have those before you in the past. So that's just one other item to bring to your attention.
That's something we do have to. I don't.
So one thing is, can we make a decision tonight? Do we have to look at the stormwater, whether it's required or not?
I don't think so.
Again, that's
like I said, they've provided more stormwater than they need to. Yeah. You know, and it's
so I think the major questions is the curb, is the, and I guess we shouldn't say curb cut, that's up to Mass DOT.
That's us, right.
From our point of view, the entrance.
Now, you say there's no legal access because of the, where the right of way was. But now, like, the owners of the Sugarloaf shop or whoever owns that property, was, are they, did they have some type of discussion saying they didn't want that happening anymore? What spurred you to do this other curb cut?
I think the survey work and the title examination raised the issue.
Dan, I can see that, but I'm like, did what really spurred you? Did they say they didn't want you using that existing curb cut now, or?
But I think, Roger, if you look at the map, the Sugarloaf shop property doesn't abut this property.
I understand.
So even if they went to Sugarloaf shop and they gave them permission, there's still a strip of land in between.
They have a right of way over that, Kip. So they don't have to get a right of way from that piece of property. That's where they're saying the legal right of way is to get out onto 5 and 10 at one time, but it's more to the south. So I just wondered if the existing owners of the Sugarloaf shop, out of curiosity, did they say, we don't want this to happen anymore? And they've used it by adverse possession, I think is the term, for more than 10 years. I think they have a right of way in and out of there already, legally.
Well, you get into your common drive bylaw and everything else. We might have a prescriptive easement in and out of the building, but I'm not sure it would comply for a change of use that we proposed here.
Yeah, I don't know either, Dan. It's not even in Deerfield.
It's in Whaley.
That's in Whaley. They have to go to Whaley for permits for all this.
They couldn't go to Deerfield to get any.
You can't get it from you.
They couldn't get that from us, right?
Right.
Well.
And I tend to agree with you. I don't like common driveways.
So what do we do?
Well, I'll make a motion that we accept the site plan review as it was put before us tonight. I mean, I think they've gone above and beyond to meet all of our requirements. I just don't see any issues with it. Whether we like the curb cut or not, that's out of our hands, and it does make it a more legal way of getting to the property. I don't know.
And if they don't get it, they come back to us.
You're right. Yeah, you're right. That's why we're asking for conditional approval. If for some reason we do not get the permit, or if they change it substantially, materially, like to the other end of the lot or something that's not been presented to you, we have to come back to you.
Given that we don't have a draft in front of us, if you want to have any conditions associated with this site plan review decision, it would be helpful if you were to have that discussion now so that I could just be the scribe in putting those down for you in your ultimate decision. I mean, you could look at the one that we just did for some example.
We need to second it, I think, before we start this.
I'm sorry.
Too much, don't we?
Yeah, I thought it was second. I'm sorry.
I didn't hear a second yet.
All right, so there's been a motion to approve the site plan. Do we have a second? Hearing none, do I have another motion? And what would that be? So if we don't approve this, we could continue it if we had more questions, I guess.
Yes.
What would
typically, in terms of, like, if you're going to make a decision on a permit or anything that is before you, the kind of the Robert's Rules of Orders are that the motions are in the positive, and then people can vote against it, but you rarely make a motion which is a negative statement.
Right.
Right.
But, so if no one's seconding it because they would prefer to wait, then that's a continuance.
Right. And then my question is, what do we do?
What are you going to continue it for?
Yeah.
I mean, I the only thing I'd like to say to our board is that, you know, if no one feels it in their heart to second this because they just are totally against this whole proposal, might I ask, why did you, in the first place, make this an overlay district in the beginning?
I was against making it an overlay district.
In fact. So there's one.
But I will say it is a lawful use, so I actually will second the motion.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah, I
because
I
it's a lawful use.
Yeah, I mean,
it's not. And they did everything they're supposed to. Although I won't vote for it, I will second the motion. How messed up is that?
That's awesome. That's perfectly appropriate.
Okay. That's now we can have discussion or whatever we need to do.
All right. So it's been moved and seconded to approve this site plan review. Any conditions? You didn't really, nothing jumped out at me when you went through your...
And we don't, I don't feel we need to address the curb cut, because if it doesn't happen, you know, it'll be bad.
Right.
Mr. Wait, point of order, should we propose a hearing for deliberation?
That wasn't done, that wasn't done, did you observe that?
I missed it.
All right, we did it really quickly.
Well, be sure you want to close it, because if you want any other information, you can't take it once you've closed it. I think a copy of your decision is one thing, but... You can deliberate before you close to, and then close at the end of that once they've got everything out, so they know that they don't need any additional info?
Yeah, but I think we want to deliberate in case we want to get some more input. So, I mean, things like, it would be great to have pedestrian access to this place, but that's more, that's not our, like you say, there's nothing...
It's not required.
From us, that's more of a, the owner might want to facilitate that somehow to keep people safe, but... So is there anything else? All right, then I'd like to close the public hearing for Greenfield Road. And with that, we have a motion and a second to approve the site plan review for 4 Greenfield Road. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstain?
I abstain with prejudice.
So Max, yours was a no?
I don't know if it is or not.
Okay.
So we got to count it up.
Aye, we had how many ayes?
Okay, I will vote.
The ayes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
And one no?
One abstention.
Do you want to give us a reason?
It's a house. It's not what I envisioned as being an industrial site.
Yep.
I envisioned a metal building with 16-foot fences and lighting and looking a little bit more like an industrial site than a residential site.
There are other better places.
And then one abstention?
I abstain, because I don't think I can lawfully say
he
no.
Can't. He has to vote against this.
All right, so it's
wait,
been...
Wait, I'm hearing that he abstained and was against it, which is...
No, he's abstained.
I'm abstaining, okay, because right, that's lawfully, there's nothing I can...
So we got a,
he's
okay.
Not, he's not.
Got it, 5-1-1.
So we would, actually, so if you give us a couple of days to write up the decision, then we'll do that, but we have...
Abstaining with prejudice.
Give us a week.
Not including the weekend this time.
Thank you very much.
All right, thanks for, some of the changes.
If you have a card, sir.
Yes. Pat, I apologize. You stayed 4 or 5 minutes longer than I promised.
Yeah.
Thank you very
much. I'm starting to turn.
That was painful.
I'm turning orange. I said I was going to turn into a pumpkin at 9 o'clock.
Thank you very much for all your work on all three of these projects. I greatly appreciate it.
So I guess the one item I am interested here is the proposed zoning change. So I don't know if Mr. Kalaszewski's had to leave already again.
He's hiding. He's back in his office.
I believe he's here, but that's not the next thing on the agenda.
Yeah, so maybe I'll just grab a copy from him. Or...
We're still in the public hearing mode. I am going to recuse myself because the fourth public hearing is
on the butter.
I have a conflict of interest.
Go sit on that bench.
I'm going to go sit on this chair out here. So I handed over.
Where is it?
Oh, yeah.
It's not on here.
Permanent.
Indeed.
Don't you dare, though.
Double driveway.
Don't you dare.
Common driveway.
Did I get mine?
These are my notes. Oh, wait a second. Did I give you the old one?
Here it is right here. Special permit.
Oh, no, it was all day long. I was looking at nothing's going on.
Special permit. Common driveway.
Okay, it's a special permit request for a common driveway at 15 Keats Road to serve 17 Keats Road. And I have a letter here addressed to the Deerfield Planning Board.
Let me have my stuff back here. The whole pile of what I have here. Thank you.
Okay. And it says, my client Daniel Malby, relief being sought an application for a special permit for a common driveway pursuant to Deerfield zoning bylaw, chapter 179, section 3460, common driveway special permit, located at 17 Keats Road. He requests to withdraw his application without prejudice. Says, "Dear board members, on behalf of my client, Daniel Mulvey, I request that he be allowed to withdraw the above reference application without prejudice."
So we're not...
I guess I'd entertain a motion to accept the withdrawal.
Now, I think some implications of this are that if he was to not have it that way, he would have a time period in which he could never apply it to again.
Well,
is that right?
I'm not sure of that. He wants to withdraw.
There's no time period to apply.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Right, he's withdrawing just it, saying,
okay.
I'm
okay.
Doing
he just
it.
Wants
yep,
to withdraw.
That's what I was asking.
So,
the motion?
Yeah, I would motion. Could you read that one more time?
It says, "On behalf of my client, Daniel Mulvey, I request that he be allowed to withdraw the above reference application without prejudice."
Mr. Chair, I think you should ask, you know, any public comment on this? Then maybe.
Would you like to speak to?
I mean, I don't mind.
Are you Matt?
I don't.
I'm Dan.
Dan.
Yeah.
I don't mind asking public comment, but if he wants to withdraw it, I don't. What's the point?
Well, no, I get it. I'm still. I mean, kind of confused. But no, I'd like to hear. Could we hear from him?
I hate to give you a point of order, but a withdrawal is a withdrawal. It's requested by his attorney to withdraw for him.
Right. Okay, so I want to make sure I'm 100% clear on this. They're withdrawing the application for the common driveway.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. That's
it. You got rid of it.
I make a motion that we accept the letter.
Well, do we even vote on it? I mean,
yes,
we do.
Yeah. Yep.
Dev, for the non-use of the common driveway.
The withdrawal of the application
for the common driveway.
Do I have a second?
What is the address on that again? So I'll add that to the motion.
It's parcel 1, 17 Keats Road.
Parcel 1, 17 Keats Road.
Yep.
That's my motion.
Max seconded.
Oh, Max seconded. Any further discussion? Should be pretty clear. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Okay.
600.
Yep.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Great.
Thanks
that was
for waiting.
Is that a copy? Yes. Can I have that, or is that?
We provided all this entertainment.
That's the only one I got.
Oh.
Look at it.
Okay. Uh-oh. Question.
Well, I asked the chair to see if anybody, but
we
I.
We have a question.
Kind of. Okay.
Public
go.
Public comment.
I'm the property owner at 15 Keats Road. Can I ask a question?
Sure.
The meeting's closed.
So, does this mean it's over? Does this keep going on?
I have no idea.
All they did was request.
I guess I got to give you an explanation.
Yeah. Well, that's what we were asking.
Yeah, that's what we're asking. Everybody's like.
Apparently, we weren't allowed to do that.
Let me give you a simpler explanation.
This looks like a copy.
It's the wrong street address and the wrong map and lot number on the application. So you would have had to throw it out anyways. So the lawyer just same face withdrawing it. Whatever you want to call it.
Okay.
He's withdrawing.
So without prejudice means they'll be back.
Without prejudice. There's an error in the application. Okay.
So we'll be seeing this again.
I didn't want to go there, but there's an error in the application.
Well, I mean, this isn't, yeah, I mean, we should know this, but it wouldn't have made a difference for the vote, but I think we should know.
I didn't want to tell you all that.
So.
It's withdrawn. They have the right to reapply at any time.
Right, because it's without prejudice.
The correct address was 15, the 17 on the application, the correct lot was mapped. 39 lot 7. This has map 39 lot 8 on it. So it's on the wrong piece of property.
All right. Well, okay. We'll see you again.
Yeah.
Perhaps not. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Does that answer your question out in the audience?
Next.
Next.
I don't know. I don't have an agenda.
You didn't get an agenda?
I got the wrong one because mine said
so.
Okay.
Mr. Chair, is this item closed for the day?
No, we got one more.
No. This item.
Yes.
So we can invite our...
So we can...
Invite John back.
We're all set. John, if you want to come back.
You can come back home, John.
No. No more defections here.
I knew it wasn't that simple.
I think we're going to have a presentation from Dick on a new zoning bylaw.
That's what's next, right?
Yep.
I guess he is coming back. I guess John sounds like he's coming back.
Yep.
The table?
Oh my goodness, we could be having a show.
Okay. I'll take that back.
Thank you.
We should get you a copy of that.
Oh, just do it.
That's all right, we're at the end.
I don't know why you, I don't know why I didn't get, know that ahead of time. No, I think that's public knowledge, I'm not sure.
I wonder about that too. Well, all these people came for something that was a...
Yeah, they should have said...
Item number six, we're going to hear from Dick Kalaszewski, our building inspector, presentation related to proposed zoning change to be considered for annual town meeting. Take it away, Dick.
I'm going to sit down before I fall down.
He gave us, everybody should have got a...
You can sit by a microphone if you would.
Town council has written...
Should have got a handout from him.
Can you hear, do you want to? Turn, or Max?
Yeah, take a microphone because it's on...
You got it. Okay. On December 28th, they changed the marijuana growing regulations to exempt it from agricultural use. So as a result, anyone who was attempting to grow marijuana for commercial purposes for medical dispensary, okay, couldn't do it now when they changed the law. So our town council wrote a bylaw to allow the grow area to be in a residential agricultural section subject to Department of Public Health regulations, which means a radius from daycares and schools, et cetera, okay? He encompasses all the areas to be equal for farmers, so if we have farmers who want to do it. It also requires a minimum of 5 acres to grow area, requires DPH approval, requires police department security approval, and licenses and permit to be issued by the Board of Selectmen, okay?
And it's still so, in the IP district?
No, it'd be in the RA district. Only RA district, okay?
Right, so go anywhere in town.
Only with 5 acres, radiuses from daycares and schools, okay? So that's the draft that the town council did, and the Board of Selectmen have approved that.
And you're saying all this, these regulations are state level?
All is regulated by state level with the exception of the 5 acres. The 5 acres, I have to say, I personally put the 5 acre minimum in because I did not want to see somebody with a 1 acre plot all over the town growing marijuana in their backyard for resale to a dispensary. So, and the DPH regulations are not finalized on any recreational thing at all, none of them. So
this is just for medical?
This is basically, right now, the only laws and the only regulations in place are for medical marijuana. This would have to be in a controlled security thing by DPA regulations, security, fencing, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah.
Now, Dick, I've just got a question here, and not that I'm against it or whatever.
No,
but,
go ahead.
But when we first talked about this and set up the overlay district for this, that wanted to be in an area where the police could get to it easily and quickly. And now this could change that completely and negate all that stuff we went through setting this
up. Not really, because the problem is that there is no space in any of the overlay districts that you did that would allow a 3 acre or 4 acre grow. Yes.
But I thought that when we did this, it was going to be inside a building.
No, the industrial park is locked out. The gentleman that was here earlier owns it all and has refused to do that. He also owns the other piece that contains the acreage that he had a previous agreement for that, and that's dead. So it's 100% dead in the water.
So is this all because
somebody maybe doesn't want to pay the rent?
No. This is because the, originally, the Department of Public Health was going to allow it in any agricultural district, just as you can grow tobacco or other plants. And the Department of Public Health then deemed somebody eliminated from Chapter 40 from farmers, okay? So that's why this came up. And this is only, the draft is only here for the planning board to hold a public hearing. That's it.
Right.
Yeah. It's not here to make a decision.
Yeah, but I guess I'm, you know, it's so different from what we talked about earlier.
Well, that's why you have the public hearing.
Well, no, I understand that, but I'm just trying to get this through my mind, is that there was such a big security issue and had to be in a building, and it had to be this, had to be that. So now you're talking about putting it outside like you would.
Yep.
P's and carrots.
We still have to have 8-foot fence, has to have security cameras.
Yeah, but there was, the cops had to go and inventory what was there and had to do all this and that. And there were all these regulations. That's what I'm trying to get figured out. Is that's all gone?
Yep.
Pretty much.
Okay.
Because of Department of Public Health has changed the ground rules. Okay. They've expanded it out. Okay. Maybe in anticipation of the recreational use. I'm not saying I agree with it either.
No.
But this is only to hold the public hearing to get public input.
And then one other question. I mean, if this in fact is geared towards recreational use down the road. But I'm saying we're setting up stuff here that what everything I've heard about recreational use is that people can have 12 plants or they can have X number of plants.
They already can do that.
Yeah, that's
a done deal.
Oh, okay. All right.
That's a done deal. You can have 12 plants at your house now.
Okay.
You don't
carry
any?
Around.
I don't think I will, but I don't know. I'll check and see.
I think you can carry around 2 ounces now legally.
Unless the feds come in and say no.
So can we schedule our job tonight is to schedule a public hearing.
Yeah, okay.
All right.
Schedule a public hearing. Be done.
Most state laws are, you can't make stuff more lenient, but you can make it stricter.
That's correct.
So we could probably stay with our area that we chose to have it raised in and still comply with what the state.
Not with this public hearing. This public hearing is specifically guidelined towards RA district.
No,
that's
but
what you have to do.
I know, but
is there a rush for this because somebody wants to do it?
What I'm saying
and
is,
and has the permits to do it?
If we didn't want to have an RA districts, we're making it more a stricter ordinance, and we're going to have an overlay district that's only going to take place in, not the whole town.
I understand what you're saying. Yeah.
So we could do that.
Well, you could. The radius, the school radiuses, daycare radiuses.
I'm just saying.
I'll give you an example. The industrial park, you asked about that, John? Mm-hmm. It's locked out because Pine Brook Daycare is across the street.
So even though that zone port,
it's locked out because
it's... Well, how far do you have to be away from...
500-foot radius.
Oh, 500 foot. I thought it was 300.
So the whole place isn't locked out.
Yeah, you only have to touch the boundary line. Who owns what? Mm.
Oh, so even if your site is in the back?
Yeah, if your building is 500 feet back.
Yeah, but that wouldn't be a big issue because it would just be a...
Just cut the...
All right. So,
but still.
So what's the timeline to get a public hearing in and then a town meeting? What?
Well, you got to do the public meeting at your hearing at your next...
Well, that's all right. We can wait till April 3rd. We don't do it early in the night.
Yeah, you can wait till April 3rd, yeah.
All right.
There's no crash program to be done on April 3rd.
Yeah.
I don't know, you can ask one of the selectmen.
There's a chance. I mean, I guess I have a question.
Well, we're
going to
have for two of these projects we're not going to see again, so.
Kip, as a select board member, has anybody approached you about this? Any?
Nope. No one has. Yeah. We just know that there is no, you know, in the overlay district, because of the way they change the rules, it's like saying no.
Because the overlay district.
Because there's no.
Not big enough.
I won't give you names. I can't over this because it's confidential. But there are two
growers,
large farmers that wanted to, are romancing people for grow. Because they need the revenue.
So new crop.
So, I mean, it's a topic a lot of, I think, Chelbourne Falls. That's on there. They're having a meeting about it, right?
A moratorium.
Well, they voted to put
a meeting for a moratorium on recreational, right?
Oh, recreational is a different subject. So are the towns doing this? I mean, eventually every town in Massachusetts has to have it.
Mm-hmm. Every town in Massachusetts will have this sooner or later.
Until they change it to something else like they just did.
Unless they regulate it like liquor licenses.
Yeah.
That only allow certain things.
Yeah, well, we jumped to and did our job to start with, and now they've changed it before we even used it.
Why only be half-baked?
Does this make sense to you? Does anybody else doing this?
I have not seen it. I'm sorry, if you could give me a copy, then I might be able to...
Well, yeah, a copy.
God, I don't...
That depends?
Yeah, here's a...
I don't disagree with you, but...
You haven't heard of any other towns doing this?
No.
My home or the guy...
No, in my experience and the workshops that I've been to and people I've spoken to, there's no contemplation of doing it outside. So you know, you guys have a whole different tradition here in town.
It's a right to farm.
Yeah.
As he's pointed out, it's definitively not an agricultural...
Right.
It's considered to be an industrial use.
Yeah.
And I have here, if you want to look at them...
Well, no, the industrial...
DPH regulations and the security regulations, while it says it could technically be outside, they are so stringent that the feeling within the community is that it's impossible to really meet them outside.
Well, that's what I thought from what we talked about before.
They're going to get tougher.
But, you know, there's more... I haven't had a chance to look at it, and you have excellent town council, and I would certainly defer to them on the legal matters, but I would love to have an opportunity.
So I propose we have a scheduled public hearing for this for April 3rd.
And work with working from this draft.
Yes.
And actually, you know what we can do, I believe, is so we're going to have Sugarloaf at 6. Let's make this public hearing start at 7, because instead of having them all start at the same time and then people have to come, does that work?
Right. Yeah.
So let's do this one at 7.
Yeah, and then you get public input and then you make your decision.
People know which one to come to, and then we can decide if we want to send it to an annual meeting or not. Yeah.
Also, at that meeting, could we schedule the height variances?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, variance, but that's a good idea.
That's my next question. Yeah. Do you want me to get the height variance change written by the town attorney so you'll have it and schedule a public hearing for that now?
Yes.
And I'll have the draft for you before then. Okay. I'll try to get it within a week.
Excellent.
And distribute it to everybody.
How many feet are we going to
Thanks, John. My next question.
What we're at? What,
well, was it 50 that we were headed to? Is that right? 35 to 50?
So we should go add another story.
I'd like to know why are we changing our height limit of variation?
Go to 50 feet?
Why? Saltchen.
Well, there's a lot of things that come up.
We've been talking about this before, Saltchen. Yeah.
Well, I'll give you mine. Mine was one example. I had to get a variance of 16 feet just because I wanted to have a cupola in the building. I mean, it's.
And Deerfield Academy just asked for one.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, was there an issue? Did you get your variance?
Yeah.
But the other.
Yeah, but that's not the right way to do it.
It's not the right way to do it.
Roger, the other. What I think. Why I think this came up is that the fire trucks, back when we did that, they could only go up so high.
Shouldn't have been granted.
That's why the fire trucks. Right, except for that it's not.
But I would want a limit?
No, there's a limit.
See, the way I look at it is if you're building up rather than out, you're reducing your footprint.
Building up is a smart growth technique, you know. So it's.
And I've looked into this a lot, and I was going to propose that we raise it to 50 feet for habitable spaces and 70 feet for any object.
That's not going
to well, if you're going to do that, it should be subject to special permit. I wouldn't go to that high.
By right, you're losing a lot of control of what's going to happen in this community. You're going to change the whole look of the town.
Yeah. I think that's a real change.
It's perfectly fine the way it is. No one has been denied. I think all you're doing is asking for trouble.
Well, I think the thought on that is that, say, let's just pick a cell tower. If somebody wanted to come in and put a 70-foot cell tower, they'd have to get a special permit to put the cell tower in anyways, separate from the thing. So they're looking for just a special permit for the cell tower, not necessarily a variance for the height. And that's why I say...
So companies can come in and put a 70-foot sign in.
We already have a 100-foot one.
Well, I know, but that was maybe before zoning.
All right, for what it's worth, I think we should have a public hearing for 49 feet. No, I'm serious. For 49 Listen. Feet, it's 13 feet greater than one. So you got a 12-foot commercial floor. That's
my, a better number. You guys think?
Because whatever we present is what we have to go.
Well, right. But if you're talking four stories, then you can round it up to 50 because you can't go.
If I get the bylaw drafted,
yeah,
and you have the public hearing, you can alter that at the hearing.
Can
correct
you do it right
Pat?
You don't have to have another public hearing after you alter it?
Depends on the nature of the change. Yeah, I mean, obviously, the point of the public hearing is to get people's input so you can make changes.
So you might change.
If it's along the same lines, you can do that. Yeah. If it changes radically, like if you were to go from, you know, by right in RA to expanding your MMOD, I would think council would probably tell you that that's
but
too substantial a change.
But you could say 55 feet and knock it down to 49 feet.
correct? Without another public hearing.
I mean, you could probably say 50 and go up to 52.
Yes, yes, you could.
Yeah.
Yes, you're right, John.
I think you're right.
You can make it shorter, but not taller.
Yes.
So why don't we say 55 feet?
Rather than expanding it.
And then we can play with it.
But, so you have nothing in front of you to set a public hearing.
I'm going to get it written out.
And so then you'd be setting the public hearing on April 3.
You can set the public hearing and our draft will be presented.
But you have to have a draft. When you publish a legal notice for a public hearing, you have to have the materials available.
We got that, we talked about it.
He's going to get it.
And get that, because you only need 2 weeks publication.
And then we're going to have.
Zoning.
You're talking about two different things.
But we're going to have one public hearing for two zoning bylaw proposed changes.
For zoning bylaw changes.
At 7:00 on April 3rd. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Okay, can I?
Wait a minute, how, okay.
7-0.
Did you vote against it or for it?
Oh, sorry.
Against it.
So it's 6-0-1 then, right?
Anybody else against it?
That's all I'm saying.
All right, sorry.
We jumped to.
It's just for a public hearing.
I know.
What I will do is get a draft of the bylaw as soon as possible from town council, which should only be a few days, and I will give it to the chairman of the planning board.
And you'll get it to all of us.
And get it distributed.
Yep.
Then you can publish for the hearing, okay?
Yep.
And then you can, like John Barona said, you can lower the height, okay?
Right.
And you can't raise it, but you can lower.
And we could do this.
And I want to give you one analogy to this is when Hardig Industries and Deerfield Plastics wanted their towers raised above the 35 feet, technically, they shouldn't have been granted a variance because it was not a hardship.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's kind of what the issue that I went through.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it made it difficult for me, although I ultimately got it, it's like, well, what's the hardship? Mm-hmm. It isn't. It was just an aesthetic thing to make it look good.
Correct, you know? Pat?
Technically, it's
not a hardship
to prove hardship.
So,
it's very difficult.
Most of them wouldn't meet that criteria.
No,
right. So that's what that's the whole point of, like, I want to put it, you know, 50 feet if it's a habitable space, then go 70 feet for an object that, you know,
so
not going to be in there.
So let me ask this question.
I'm not quite sure that should be.
So do you want to put habitable space in there for discussion?
That or just one? Just one.
Non-habitable space.
This vote covers
for discussion,
it.
Not habitable.
Just changing the 35 to 55.
Yeah,
change it 55, but do you want to also include a clause in there for non-habitable space, meaning a clock tower?
Church.
I mean, tell me what you want, how you want it written.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going over to Roger's side and saying, you know, if it's a thing like that, you apply for variance and you get it.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, but it's kind of, you have a little more control than everybody's throwing up antennas on there.
55 so, feet, right?
Yeah. I think 55 is.
Okay.
But, I just want to go back here for a minute. Are you going to advertise this as zoning bylaw changes of marijuana and height of this?
Separate.
Well, separate.
Why are you getting so
are they separate. Going to be separate? That's what I was just asking.
It's one public hearing for proposed bylaw changes.
Are we voting for two things or one?
Mr. Chair, do we have any?
That's all I'm asking.
One public
hearing
for proposed bylaw changes.
Okay.
Then item one is the marijuana thing. Item two is the height.
That's all I was asking.
Yeah.
So there's two zoning bylaw changes, but one
public hearing.
Public hearing
I
on
will
the
clarify yes. that through town council for you.
Okay.
Okay.
And we
there
already
should
took
be a little bit of language kind of.
Yeah, I'll get that
a
written.
A little bullet point what the changes
right.
are.
That's what
I'll get
gonna,
that written for you.
Yeah. It'd be important to say marijuana and
there will be separate legal notices. To,
See, now you're saying separate legal notices, so that's what
is
I'm.
Is there any other business not reasonably anticipated 48 hours prior to the proceeding of this? Set date for hearing.
I was in the.
That's what we just did. All right, set date for next meeting. So obviously April 3rd is our next meeting, 6:00, and we already have most of the agenda taken care of.
So April 3rd is our next meeting.
Do I have a motion to adjourn?
I'd like to make a motion to adjourn.
I'll second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Passed unanimously. Thank you very much for another late 3.5 hours.